Hi, this is Michael Buffer, and you're listening to the voice of the people. Let's get ready for Boxing Voice.
BoxingVoice.com.
What broke him down? Was it
the body punching?
I was hitting with body punching. I heard him actually he was crying there. You're saying your big was crying when you hit him? Yes. When did that happen? And perhaps the fourth round on.
BoxingVoice.com.
So that you knew you had him by that
Absolutely.
Time.
Absolutely, but I
knew you were cuffing and taking those punches.
DBLC Productions.
Making women's gestures like,
let's go, champ. This is the champ. Keep saying the champ. With the fake champ.
It's the champ, ladies and gentlemen. Hashtag TBV podcast. We are back with a jam-packed lineup. All the hosts together with foaming like Voltron out here. We got Gerald Washington. He's going to be taking on Deontay Wilder. We'll have him sometime during the show. One of the producers will give you the right time. But if you want to talk about Adrien Broner and the fact that he's back on the scene, this fight was scheduled at 140, then 147, rumors 150. Is Adrien Granados really the new Marcos Maidana? Marcus Brown, Thomas Williams Jr., great fight on the undercard. Lamont Peterson versus David Avanesyan, another card on the undercard. Good fight. Then we got to talk Lomachenko. Is he being ducked, even though he has this fight signed with Jason Sosa? Got to talk about Jason Sosa vacating titles. Speaking of vacating titles, I know that Matt wants to speak of the IBF, well, former IBF champion now, Jermall Charlo, who also vacated his title. That title will also be on Deontay Wilder's card for a vacant title shot for Jared Hurd and Tony Harrison. And last but not least, you know, the world went to see Keith Thurman. We're going on Monday. You know, private TBV status, but we were there in Danny's gym yesterday, so we have to bring you the updates. Let's head on over to the Garden State.
What's up, man? Yeah, I just want to say I saw a fight too.
Stay focused. Stay working my day.
I saw a fight too.
Guys, I'm saying, like, boxing
boys. Because if you come to fight, then I'm going to look for it, man.
I saw a fight too.
I think you're accurate.
Yeah. What's up, man? You know, it's Thursday, so you know what that means, prediction day, like Ness was bringing all those fights up. But me, the one that's on my timeline and the most important fight to me, of course, is Adrien versus Adrien. That's Broner versus Granados. So, yeah, that's what I'm looking forward to. And then something else snuck up. What was that, man, about Andre Berto? I didn't get that.
Yeah, Berto's getting chased by reporters or ambushed by the porters. I don't know.
BoxingMD, what's going on, brother? I know you want to sit in on this.
We're going to head on over to a doctor.
The Sunshine State.
BoxingMD, what's going on?
Is that a fair statement to me? You have to be honest with yourself.
Glad to be back with the full panel of hosts, and I'm also glad to see Adrien About Billions Broner get back in the ring Saturday. He still brings entertainment to a sport that needs people who entertain. And I know Adrien Broner is a punchline, right? But Saturday night, you're going to be entertained somehow to some degree. So.
I know a mingle who will charge you zero and throw you a kilo.
Woo!
I bet in a week, your pockets be stuffed like Chipotle burritos.
I don't know. Is this going to be the week that Adrien Broner comes back to graces? Even though he's been all in the headlines with weight issues, let's head on over to the Golden State to none other than the hipster. What's going on, Matt Hunter? How's the weather over there for you, California guys? Well,
right now, the weather's good, but we're going to get about like 6 to 10 inches of rain pretty much throughout the whole state this weekend. So it's going to be nice to go out to Florida, get some sunshine, you know, beat up MD. It's going to be fun. I can't wait. But
I love how he says that so nonchalantly.
It is true. But anyways, I digress. You know, as a hipster, there's one other news fact that we haven't brought up. Robert Easter Jr. and Dennis Shafikoff has been ordered by the IBF and has a great fight in the lightweight division. Hey, Denis Shafikov beat Richard Comey, and he arguably beat Rancis Bartholomew. So let's get real. Denis Shafikov's the boogeyman of that division. That's a good fight. That don't impress
me much. Yo, that fight with Richard Comey in someone's backyard, I watched it with the white ring apron. Please, man. I mean,
what do you mean in someone's backyard? There's three American judges. There was no Russian judges in that backyard fight. That
shit. Yo, are you talking about the one in the dining hall?
Yeah.
Dining
hall. Yeah. It looked like it was a club fight at Robert Street Hotel.
Please. Yeah, downtown in status, you know, status.
But he still arguably beat Rancis Bartholomew. I know he didn't, but Denis Shafikov arguably won 7 rounds out of that fight.
You know, this is what I love about having a full panel of hosts on, because, you know, every opinion is there. You see, he's not going to, you know, not allow the opinion of the hardcore to be heard. But, I mean, is Denis Shafikov really a sexy name? Let's speak about what is sexy. Actually, no. Oh, my God. How could we forget the glue? Jeez. I mean, it's because it's been so long. It's been a whole 7 days, for God's sakes.
Nothing but smooth. Yo, you were talking to Proby. You could have kept where it was going, you know, keeping it sexy. That's right, switching it back my way. That's the most appropriate way to introduce me.
Now, what did Sergey Kovalev have? What is that? What do you got on over there?
Yo, this is from the second appreciation night that ever happened. We're bumping up the new one. It's going to be happening in less than a month.
Yes, I got relax. Andre Ward's name is on it too. Relax.
Ward, that's so last year. We're like Danny Thurman this year, you know what I mean? Like, you're so last year right now.
No, 2016. Give me a hat. No, 2016.
He's showing his lifestyle. Right?
This is the biggest fight of 2016. I'm really excited for the biggest fight of 2017 so far. Would you say that Adrian Broner's return is the biggest fight of 2017? Yeah. We're all gonna do it.
Yo, MD's lap will live forever, I swear. Listen, let's get to the real sexy stuff. Adrian versus Adrian, drop the E, add the A, however you want to do it. How good of a fight is this? I mean, the media is definitely propping this guy up. I don't know who got paid. You know, the resemblance to Marco Maidana, I do not see it. I don't even know what the comparison, why it's out there.
I know where it came from, because I fell victim. I just did the whole resume of Granados. The Amir Aman fight, you know, I didn't know him. I saw him beat him. I saw him finish him. And he won by a KO, by stoppage. So you don't see anything before that. You don't box wreck him. You don't see his record. You're like, yo, this is the kid that beat that up and coming. That he was a champion, wasn't he, Amir Aman?
Well, he wasn't a champion. Definitely heavily touted prospect. We can't even call him a contender. Definitely heavily touted prospect.
And he was a knockout. Your eyes on him. Knockout fighter, yes or no? Amir Aman, that is.
He was looking good. He was looking great.
Finishing, and Granados finished him. So now, after seeing Granados' highlights, seeing him on BKB a lot, you know, my mind has shifted that Adrian Broner is going to look freaking phenomenal on Saturday.
Yo, Enrique, a good comparison would be what's his name? The guy who Jesse Vargas knocked out, Saddam Ali. It's about the same, right? It has that effect. And this is what I don't see. I don't see Adrian Granados having that type of power. Just because he got that win, his career, he's never shown to be like Adrian Broner. He's not good when he has pressure and power, pressure and power, and he has to fight off the back foot. If somebody is standing in front of him and kind of giving him space, he doesn't have to move that much. He will win the fight. But I don't think that, you know, Adrian Granados has that type of pressure to win.
Yeah, I just saw his highlight reel. He's wide open. So he may be a punching bag on Saturday. And no disrespect to him. I'm just giving my fanatic.
Nah, no disrespect. Call him a punching bag.
Nah, I mean, against Adrian Broner.
That 50 Cent laugh, too. Yo, that's that 50 right there. No, but you can't call him a punching bag and expect it not to be disrespectful. I mean, punching bags don't even hit back. They just take shots.
Nah, I mean, against Adrian Broner, he makes you look that way. You know, he can't.
Yeah, but Broner, come on. Like, the same Broner that did not throw a single punch in how many rounds against Sean Porter?
Well, I mean,
that's the point, though.
Like, you still have the X factor with Broner. We don't know.
Sean Porter brings that type of size and pressure, which
Granados
does not have. So you can't just, you know, that doesn't come from nowhere.
No, I think Broner has issues mentally in the ring. I think that's an X factor that we cannot quantify. We have no idea if it's going to play a factor in this fight.
We don't know.
We don't know, but I'm still picking Broner. Like you guys say, I think Granados is open to counters. I think Broner's naturally the bigger guy. He hits harder. He's faster. He's overall more experienced. It's hard to pick Granados in this, and if you do, it's an upset pick, and you're going off of faith almost, in my opinion.
Right.
You ain't got the answers, man. You ain't got the answers.
Yo, to be honest.
And hold on, very quickly. Granados does not have one punch knockout power. He wore down Amir Aman, and that's how he got the finish. It's not like he's some heavy hitter. Maidana at least had somewhat more power, in my opinion, than Granados.
I was just going to shift into Maidana being the style that Granados has to present, but you just said he doesn't have that power. So.
Or mimic. He's going to have to mimic it for sure, but can he do it? He's such a thin-looking gentleman. I don't know. You know, what's interesting is maybe our listeners don't know, maybe my panelists don't know, but Granados has spent multiple training camps with Adrien Broner, so they do know each other. He may have that confidence, like, man, I've gave this guy some good rounds in sparring. Maybe I could do it. And just remember, since we're talking levels here, and there obviously are levels in boxing, and Adrien is on, propped up on one above this Adrien Granados, so we believe, but it was a tough fight with he and Emmanuel Taylor, another guy that one may believe is kind of on the same level as an Adrien Granados. Am I right?
Right.
No, I hear you. And Ness, I'm sure you've seen multiple sparring, you know, matches or footage of Adrien Broner. Like, he fucks around in sparring, so maybe he has confidence. I just think that he is a sparring partner, like, no disrespect. And I think Adrien Broner has only lost to a few extremely good and physical opponents, and he still is an extremely talented boxer, Adrien Broner. He could come in fat out of shape, which is what he is going to be, right? Because he couldn't change. He's not changing anything. It doesn't seem like it. He's not changing his lifestyle. He's not losing the weight. He's still saying ridiculous shit. So I think this is the same old Adrien Broner, which is enough to easily beat Adrien Granados.
Now, when do they – let me ask you guys this. Enrique, you were going to talk. I'm sorry to cut you off. I'll ask you so you can answer. When do you think PBC, the powers that be, it's R&R Promotions, when do they get tired of Adrien and say, let's serve him up to Errol Spence. Let's serve him up to someone we know is going to eat him up, not a 50-50. Someone we know that's like, oh, shit, he's getting in there with – Broner's getting in there with Earl. He's getting in there with Calbert. Like, we know it's a cash out because – I mean, at this point, you keep trying to save this franchise that every day in the news is on fire, basically. Well, he does something every day.
Well, McDonald's isn't healthy for you, but it's a lucrative fast food place, right? So that's what Adrien Broner is. And we're going to tune in on Saturday. But what I wanted to bring out was Felix Diaz beat Adrien Granados. I didn't know that, but that's a name that sticks out. And a better matchup, just knowing that, would have been Broner versus Diaz. So he would have been the, and I can be 100% wrong, he would have been the Maidana-style fight. And that's why they're not matched up, because that franchise must
have. Yeah, but Diaz doesn't have that much power. I don't think he would have presented any more danger than Granados in terms of power.
Skill-wise, Felix Diaz could be on the inside and give him trouble.
The way that he moves in the ring, he probably...
But he's tiny, though. That's the thing. I don't think he's big enough to bully him like Maidana did. He's like 5'5". He's a tiny fighter. And I think that he's physical, but he cannot bring the same pressure that Sean Porter or Maidana brought to Broner to give him issues like that.
Paulie Malignaggi arguably beat Adrien Broner.
But that's like a different – but Matt, that's a different, entirely different style. I said
there's guys that don't have to have power, don't have to be that huge pressure guy, and they can still beat Broner. Broner is beatable. Let's not act like Broner is like this unbeatable guy. You know, like, there's a reason why Ness brought up. Is it almost time to start feeding him to an Errol Spence or a Keith Thurman or – a Danny Garcia or somebody like that? You know, like, there's a reason why we start thinking that. It's because he is beatable. He has shown so many chinks in his armor that it's hard to favor him in almost every fight. There's a reason why there's a vocal minority of people picking Adrien Granados.
I mean, really, if you're going to keep being nice to Broner, I think after this, you give him a Berto fight. You know, it's tough enough.
That's a good fight.
But good enough. That he could, like, yeah, he be good enough that he could win, but Berto's tough enough.
Yo, you don't think he wins? He easily beats Andre Berto.
Listen to me. It's a good enough fight that he can possibly win, but he is small enough that he may not win, okay? Whatever you want to think of Berto, MD, his power is absolutely real. And he's hurt people in the past.
Adrien Broner doesn't have a chin, right?
He does.
A great chin. Exactly.
But that's why it would be a good matchup stylistically.
A good matchup, but I think that you guys are being really harsh on Adrien Broner as like a boxer, because he might not be the superstar or the future of boxing like a lot of people thought he would, but he is talented enough. He has fast enough hand speed, has enough natural talent to get him through a lot of these fights, right?
So yeah, but I think which fights? If the boy can't make 140 and he went to 147, then unofficially they're talking this fight is at 150. Which division could he really campaign and successfully win a title that isn't vacant, that isn't set up for him the way that Jared Hurd and Tony Harris?
He doesn't get the treatment like Danny Garcia does and graduate into 147-pound weight division.
He did. A big opponent. My friend, don't forget that he chose to jump from 135 to 140. He got the Paulie Malignaggi fight, but then he bit off more than he could chew by going in after Maidana, which reneged him back. He decided to reset, went back down to 140. Now he can't even make it. Any decent fights that he's had there have been guys with no power.
But even though he bit off more than he could chew against Maidana, right, he still showed in that fight that he's a good fighter, because he took some big, like some huge punishment from Maidana and still had moments of, you know, you could see the natural talent.
But he also showed that it's very difficult for him to, you know, maintain with those bigger guys in that division.
But I don't think there's that many Maidanas. Maidana's a stylistically, I mean, look what he did to Floyd, right? Maidana's going to give any less physical boxer an issue, because he is, you know, the engine that kept going, right? He's like Ruslan Provodnikov, but better. You know what I'm saying? More efficient at his pressure. Because Maidana does not do anything technical. He's not a slick fighter. He's not a,
but he's physically imposing, right? Like he's a big, big boy. The wild nature is not something that everyone can deal with. People get afraid of elbows and headbutts, you know what I mean? They don't act or react naturally, but we spoke enough about it. I mean, it's not really two same level fighters in the main event, but what is evenly matched and a very sexy, sexy fight for me is Marcus Browne versus top dog Thomas Williams Jr. He has that one loss, I believe, to Adonis Stevenson, maybe even two, but this guy, Thomas Williams Jr., he comes out all guns blazing. Marcus Browne is a very, I don't want to say very good boxer, but I think that when he wants to, he can box. He fights from out the southpaw style. But I don't like the way that he deals with pressure. And Williams, he just, that's all that he is pressure. Remember the Edwin Rodriguez fight? That was a slugfest until one man checked out. And I question, Matt, does Marcus Browne have the power of a Thomas Williams? I think not.
So I was watching a bunch of tape on them today because I thought this was the fight that had the biggest question mark on it out of this card. So I wanted to refresh myself as much as possible. And man, Marcus Browne, he can get touched. Like, that's the thing. Like, his last fight against a Kalijic or whatever his name is, I don't know how to pronounce it. It was like 21-0, a no name, but he looked really good. I want to see him again, even though he lost. You know, I think that Marcus Browne, like you said, doesn't deal with pressure well. He dips too low. He allows himself to get hit with uppercuts, with right hands often. Now, because Thomas Williams is also a southpaw, maybe that right hand is not really going to be a thing. But Marcus Browne doesn't have a good lead hand as a southpaw. He does have a strong right hand for jabs, for a check hook. He's mainly a big, you know, big shot with the left hand. That's it. That's all he has. So I think that he's probably going to get knocked out in this fight. I think Thomas Williams, to me, is just a little more durable. Even though he himself can get touched and hurt, I think he has better recovery abilities. And I just see him overpowering Marcus Browne and getting a late-round TKO.
I don't know if the rest of the panel has noticed, right? Like, I agree with just about everything Matt is saying, except the knockout part. Because the asterisk next to Williams is that he may be knocked out. The one to truly show chinny behavior is Top Dog. I mean,
what do you mean? Marcus Browne was knocked down twice against.
But Top Dog's been knocked out, and I remember I'm
Adonis Stevenson. Adonis Stevenson has a
all right. But what about in the Campillo fight?
That's a good point.
I don't know if he won that fight or not, but I remember him being down in that fight. I watched that.
He lost the fight to Campillo, while on the other hand, Marcus Browne actually stopped Campilla.
Exactly. Like, top dogs.
They both have chin issues. They both have question marks on their chin.
But I think the top dog
not has really, more though. Of an issue. Yeah, I agree. And that's what I think Thomas Williams is, he has pressure, but he's so wide when he commits to throw his work. Like when he was fighting Adonis Stevenson, I know it's Adonis Stevenson, he was winging punches, right? And also, honestly, is Edwin Rodriguez a knockout artist? He really, really, really hurt Thomas Williams, right? And I think Marcus Browne is not as good as we expected him to be because he was an Olympian. But I think that a fighter who's coming straight in, right, like he's going to come in a straight line, I think will be open enough to get hit clean by Marcus Browne, which is why I'm picking Marcus Browne via knockout.
No way.
Marcus Browne?
No way. We were on a phone call, and you like gave me shit for even bringing up that Marcus Browne could win.
Well,
You and Ness.
He is more of the boxer, I'm telling you.
Well, you know what,
Matt? I'm just shocked.
This is the official pick, and this is what I'm doing, and that's my pick.
Going to upset. I like it.
Round by decision?
By knockout.
Ooh.
Thomas Williams is going to be coming in straight.
And I
believe day on Sunday. Whew.
I believe that Browne has the ability to do it. But because I don't trust the way that he handles pressure, I think the probability of Thomas Williams knocking him out, or at least dropping him, is going to happen first. Bold pick, MD. Enrique, my casual friend, my buddy, my pal.
Let's go.
You don't know these guys?
I mean, I heard the names. I never really saw them fight, so I don't.
Let me refresh your memory, right? I know I got a black and white picture here for Marcus Browne, but he's the guy that got knocked out by the Floridian hot rod, Calorigio. Remember? Did he sound like the dude from Bronx Tale? Maybe. No? Marcus Browne.
Yeah, man.
Hold on, guys. You heard the cut it. You know I only cut it when we have a really important person, like a guest, on the line. And with me, I have none other than Gerald Washington, as promised. Mr. Washington, are you there?
Yeah, I'm here. How you guys doing?
We are happy to have you, Gerald. We want to thank you.
Hello.
We got you. We're happy to have you. We want to thank you for taking out the time to give us the opportunity to interview you. El Gallo Negro, very appreciative of your time.
Yeah.
You're coming into, obviously, the fight of your life thus far. An opportunity at the WBC title, very luxurious title, one that even Muhammad Ali has held. I mean, how is this moment for you? How are you taking it all in?
Oh, man, it's very exciting, man. You know, all I'm thinking, all I got in my mind is just prepare, man. You know, put this plan together, get ready to take this dude's belt, man, bring this back home. We're working hard, man. My trainer and I, man, we got a great game plan. And it's gonna be a beautiful night, man. It's gonna be a lovely day.
Now you took this fight on short notice, obviously. It's not something that you would have normally done, right? Like ideally you would have wanted an 8-week camp for, you know, the biggest fight of your career, but you had to take whatever came your way. How do you capitalize on this moment knowing that, you know, you didn't have the full training camp? Your mindset wasn't 100% focused on Deontay Wilder because you had another opponent.
Yeah, but, you know, and the great part about us, man, we're constantly working. We always had Deontay Wilder and all the other champions in mind anyway. You know, when you're training and you're coming up the ranks, you keep those guys. And I'm looking at those guys anyway because they got the same, you know, body type and frame as I do. Deontay Wilder, Anthony Joshua, Klitschko. I got my eye on all those guys, man. So I'm always learning how to fight, you know, prepare for those guys. And you know, it was just a flip the switch for us, you know what I mean? It's just say, okay, now we're going to be fighting Deontay Wilder. Okay, cool. So now we just got to set the game plan. But we're already in shape, man, so we don't have to worry about that part. You know, all we got to do is worry about our game plan. We can come up with a great game plan in a month.
Hey, Gerald, so this is Stephen Calder on the producer again. So just a quick question. Deontay Wilder did an interview with us through Ness, and he mentioned about how he did spar with you before and that you know, he was kind of bragging a bit, saying that he gave you a concussion and that
you might still be concussed now. Do you think that he holds any type of mental edge over you right now going into this fight?
I mean, Deontay Wilder, it was real choppy, man. I couldn't hear everything that you guys were saying, but all I heard was the last part, that he have a mental edge. I mean, like I said, I'm not worried about Deontay Wilder. I'm concerned with myself and my team and my preparation. As long as I'm 100%, man, I'm going to beat Deontay Wilder. You know, he can feel how he wants to feel about me. Yeah, he has experience. He's been in the ring. He's been champion for a while. He's defended it a couple of times, but he's never been in the ring with anybody like me. So I'm bringing that to the table, man. I'm coming hard, man. So if he underestimates me, you got to rule the weight.
What's going on, Gerald? This is BoxingMD. Obviously, Deontay Wilder is coming off an injury with his right hand. Do you believe that his hand is 100%? And does that affect, obviously you can't give away your game plan, but does it affect how you train at all, you know, to assume that maybe he hasn't recovered 100%, relying a lot on his left hand instead of his right?
Yeah, you guys ever play that game, Bloody Knuckles? I'm going to punch him in his right hand as hard as I can, man, and take him out of there.
Hey, man, that'd be at least a good game plan if happening.
Nah, it's all good, man. We're preparing for the best Deontay Wilder that we got. We're not concerned about any of that, man. We're not concerned with his bicep. We're not concerned with his hand. You know, we're just looking for the best Deontay Wilder. You know, I don't want to – I'm hoping he's at 100% because I don't want to hear any excuses. I don't want to hear anything, man, because I'm going through my share of stuff, too. Everybody goes through the bumps and bruises in camp, you know what I mean? So – I'm working through it, man. I'm bringing all I got, man. If he's not ready, he don't have to fight on February 25th. He can hold on, you know. He can go ahead and pass me that belt if he wants. But I don't want to hear any excuses about a hand or bicep or nothing like that after we fight, man. I'm going there to fight the best Deontay Wilder, and I'm handling my business.
Gerald, it's Enrique Church, the casual fan. So you mentioned you want to be 100%, right? The fight is only about 9 days away. 8 days away. What percentage you think you at right now?
Yeah. No, I'm at a good percent. I'm good. I'm saying I'm preparing for 100%. Deontay Wilder at 100%. I'm not worried about him and his injuries or whatever. You know what I'm saying? I said everybody goes through their bumps and bruises through camp, but I mean I'm gonna be good, man. I'm gonna be 100%. You know, I'm gonna be focused. I'm gonna be locked in on the fight night, man. And whether I'm 100% or not, man, you guys ain't gonna know nothing. You guys is gonna know that I'm there to fight. You're gonna see that. That's what you're gonna see.
So, Gerald, I mean, can you let us know who you use for preparation for this fight? Like, who were you able to find to mimic his height, his style, or are you not concerned with any of that? You know, what sort of choosing and selection did you use for sparring partners?
Yeah, I mean, he got different skills that he brings to the table. He's a big, long guy. He's 6'7". You know, he has long reach and stuff. So we got a tall guy, too. But it's hard to find the exact combination of guys. But, you know, I picked a lot of guys that were, like, more built for speed and faster guys because he is pretty explosive. So that's what I want to prepare for. I'm not worried about the length and the size. I could deal with that all day. I deal with that all day. We get plenty of sparring guys that are 6'5", and 6'6", 6'7". That's not the issue. The issue is what can he do athletically and how he carries himself around the ring, man. So that's why we're dealing with faster fights, man. A lot of cruiserweights and guys with speed.
Do you take, I guess, any confidence in the fact that the both of you share a similar amateur background where you're both not that experienced in the amateur world and you're learning on the job as a professional?
I mean, yeah, he's got to go around the world and compete and stuff like that, man. But, you know, my 14 amateur fights, man, those as real as they come, man. You know, I come from the hard streets of Vallejo, California. So yeah, man, nah, it's not about that, man. It's not about that for me. I get plenty of experience in sparring and in training, and we work on stuff, man. We really lock in and key in on things that we need to work on. And I know how to deal with Deontay Wilder. You know what I mean? So, like I said, if I'm at my best, I will beat Deontay Wilder.
All right, Joe. Well, my last question, obviously, can you let me know how you've envisioned it? I mean, I could only imagine that if I were going up for the heavyweight title of the world, I'd be dreaming myself to sleep and envisioning how I'm going to win it, how it's going to go down, or what happens after. I mean, when you close your eyes at night as these days approach, what thoughts do go through your mind?
Man, I just look at him, man, and I see a man. You know what I'm saying? I see a guy that's you know, he comes to fight. I'm very capable, man. I don't put too much out there. You know, I'm just saying I'm well prepared for the fight. You know, I've dealt with his style. I like his style, and I'm very comfortable with it. And I look forward to stepping to him, man.
Looks like we dropped him, Steven, but I know he's on a tight time schedule anyway. See if you could get him back. If not, well, there you have it. That was Gerald Washington. He didn't really get my question. I was more interested in at night, Enrique, when he goes to sleep, he lays his head down. What's going through his mind? How does he envision beating this giant? I mean, it's going to be so many people cheering and bam. I mean, does he see a straight right? What does he see? Is his coach propping him up? Is he on the corner on a turnbuckle saying strap me up a la Floyd? I mean, give me something. What do you think? How do you think it's gonna play out, Enrique?
I don't know, man. I kind of think really high of the heavyweight champion Deontay Wilder, and he's bomb squad. He's gonna come in. I wanted to ask him about like when they face off, and if he gets in his face, like what are his thoughts at that point, you know? But you asked him what is his thought at night if Deontay Wilder got real gangster tough on him.
Yo, casual.
Yo.
Yo, can you hear Gerald? Mr. Washington, can you say something?
Nah, we can't hear him, but tell him it's all good, man. We do appreciate the time. We will get you back again. I know it is a difficult one. He is in the middle of training. He's at the gym, so we just want to, you know, thank him for giving us the opportunity during training for what is ultimately the biggest fight of his career. We obviously touched on Marcus Browne. MD made his official.
Yeah, that's one sec. You really fucked up in that interview because you didn't ask him why didn't he get a Greek god as a sparring partner to imitate Deontay Wilder, right? You know what I mean?
Well, I don't think I've ever.
That was a good MD joke. That was a good one. That was a good one.
Well, I don't think I've ever used the term Greek god when speaking of Wilder. If anything, I've probably said that about Joshua.
I think you have.
Yeah, about Joshua probably. So, you know, he fucked up. But
yeah,
that happens often.
No, I understand what you're saying.
Lamont Peterson.
Because it was the way you asked who did they bring in for sparring. Just go back and listen. That's all I got
to
say.
Well, yeah, I said who did they bring in for sparring to mimic the 6'7 Deontay Wilder. I mean, it's not easy, right? Or is he 6'9? Something, I know he's tall.
No, he's 6'7.
You know?
Did everyone make their picks for the Thomas Williams, Marcus Browne fight, though? I don't know if Enrique made his pick or Steven or you, Ness.
Who you pick?
Man, bro. I'm in those places where I'm starting to think, like, I was at the Danny Garcia gym yesterday, and like, who you got? Who you got? Everybody with a DSG shirt and hat running down on me and shit. Like, they got a gun in their hand. Who you got? Who you got? I think I'm going to stop picking, man, because people get, you know,
you got
I know you're right. I know it's boo, but you got to understand. Like, I mean, guys is getting offended. Like, look, I mean.
It's your job. To job like, pick, just like it's their job to fight.
I like Marcus Browne, you know.
Hello, guys. Can you hear me?
Yes, we can hear you.
You obviously wasn't hearing us. That's the thing.
We're going to bring Mr. Washington back on so we can finish his piece on what he was saying before. Mr. Washington, can you go ahead and start speaking for us? Make sure we can hear you nice and loud.
We don't hear him.
No.
Whatever.
No, unfortunately not.
Whatever you got, Steven, you need to pay attention to us. Someone text him in the chat there, Matt.
Yo, Ness, so if you want to recluse yourself from making picks, right?
I'm not. Listen.
If you're becoming Hollywood, right? Ness is becoming too Hollywood because he can't put his opinions out there anymore.
No, it's not that I'm becoming Hollywood, bro. I mean, remember, you're staying in Gainesville. I'm the one that's flying around and driving around to these fights, and then they're not happy.
You just got to say, I'm picking how I see it. And if I'm wrong, I'm not the smartest guy. You just got to go with that.
So then tell me what happened. Tell me what happened in the past then.
Well, that's what I'm saying. You could either recluse yourself from making picks or you got to take them seriously. Because you're going to hurt somebody's feelings, right? Someone's feelings will be hurt. And you can't go halfway.
You will make
wrong picks just like I will, and someone will be offended. It's just how it works, right?
Listen, like I said, I am picking Thomas Williams Jr. Thomas Williams Jr. That's what I'm doing. What about you, Matt?
I told you I'm picking Thomas Williams. You know, even though he blocked me on Twitter for I don't know why.
Oh my god. Yo, why do you got so much beef with people,
B? I don't have beef with him at all. Like, that's the weird part. I don't know why he blocked me. I just realized it one day.
But anyway. I didn't even know Thomas Williams Jr. has a Twitter, to be honest.
Oh, yo. Yo, check that's out cool. Mr. 500 right here. Check out Mr.
500. Yo, I'm not saying, you know, I'm just saying I didn't know Thomas Williams Jr. has a Twitter.
Yo, MD just followed me. It's like,
MD. Yeah, he just followed me too. That was weird.
He had a glitch. Somehow someone jacked MD. He doesn't want to tell the truth, but he went from everyone he was following and ended up saying zero follows. So someone did some hacking to MD. I hope you changed the password, MD. Listen, let's get to David Avanesyan, who took care of Shane Mosley and now has himself a shot at Lamont Peterson. And if anyone can say that he has a shot at Lamont Peterson, it is definitely now, Matt, because Peterson's been out of the ring for, well, ever since the Felix Diaz.
Robbery. You know, robbery.
Controversial win.
That was a robbery. That was bullshit. Felix Diaz stomped his ass, okay? That's why Felix Diaz could be ranked top 10 in two divisions because he beat Sammy Vasquez and he beat Lamont Peterson. But I digress. I still favor Lamont Peterson, though, in this fight. You know, yeah, there's going to be some ring rust. He may not look good in the first rounds, but David Avanesyan is not a fast starter. He's not a volume puncher. He's a guy that just sorts of – he comes forward. He throws two or three punch combinations. And his biggest win was Shane Mosley last year. You know, I don't know. I'm not sold on David Avanesyan. He's a guy that sort of been around having fights with people. I favor Lamont Peterson. He's faster. He hits harder, better defensively, better ring generalship. He should win this one if he's not looking completely out of his element because of the ring rust. So I'm favoring Lamont Peterson to win by unanimous decision.
He is the more experienced guy. And the good doctor.
Well, I think Lamont Peterson is a much better fighter, even though I think he's a little past his prime. I feel like David Avanesyan, I don't even know how to pronounce his last name properly. Let me look at how to spell it. Whatever.
Can we get Jeffrey over here to help us out?
Avanesyan. Absolutely. So, the good doctor with that degree and all.
Yeah, you know.
I just don't want to get it.
Degree helps him with the name.
I don't want to get it 100% wrong. It's a difficult name to pronounce, but he's an Eastern European.
Avanesyan.
Do it again.
David Avanesyan.
The issue with whatever his name is, the computer programming, it doesn't take in consideration origin of name.
Why do you disrespect Jeffrey like that, yo?
I mean, Jeffrey just takes whatever. It's not the highest level language grader, but the thing is that
he sounds more proper than you, my friend.
Okay, so that guy, right? He's a come forward Eastern European style fighter without power, which I think is tailor made for Lamont Peterson to use his legs, use his speed and his range, and box circles around the entire night. But I think it'll go to a points decision. And Matt, I just want to clarify one thing. I thought I was at the Felix Diaz fight and I rewatched it. I thought Felix Diaz won, but it was not a stomping. It was a hard fought win, a clear decision.
True. I'm obviously doing hyperbole because I'm a Felix Diaz fan. Like, if people haven't realized that yet, I love Felix Diaz.
Really?
Yeah. Shut up, man. But yeah, you're right. It was a hard fought fight. It was I wouldn't say that. It was controversial. I would say it was a robbery, though, because I think that a majority of fans thought that Felix Diaz won. I think that I haven't met anyone that ever thought that Lamont Peterson won that fight. I have not met a single person that thought that.
I'm gonna go with LP on this one.
LP. Have it.
Even though, you know, he's lost against a lot of good fighters. Like
Danny. A lot? Damn, he only got three losses, buddy.
Well, they were all the good fighters, right? In that division, Lucas Matisse, Danny Garcia, and Timothy Bradley, right? So, yeah, he's fighting.
And he was definitely competitive in the Danny Garcia fight.
I don't know.
And he was definitely looking good in that Amir Khan fight, you know. You know what? When I really started to like Lamont Peterson, when he was able to come back versus Victor Ortiz, you know, prime Victor Ortiz. Victor Ortiz dropped this kid three times in the first round. This kid got up and was able to fight a draw, which most people thought he probably won. And I was like, wow. And you take him back to the Bradley fight. I mean, he was young in the Bradley fight. You know, boxing wasn't what it is now, you know? There were a lot of little promoters, you know? We don't even hear about Gary Shaw anymore, but it was so many little promoters, and Peterson was signed to a small one. He ended up taking that Bradley fight maybe a little too soon, you know, being homeless and shit, living in cars before HBO started propping him. You know, he took this fight on Showbox with Bradley. And even I believe he dropped Bradley, if not Bradley dropped him. But we're talking too much. Listen, I'm going to go with Peterson as well. I think Avanesyan hasn't faced anybody besides Mosley. He hasn't, like, yo, I don't even know anybody in there. Like, he hasn't even been on this level. Peterson better stop this kid. I don't care. He's been out a year, but he's always in the gym. I mean, always in the gym. So he better stop this kid that nobody ever heard of. Speaking of,
but Ness, do you not see the miles though a little bit with Peterson? I saw it in the Felix Diaz fight.
No, I think that the Diaz fight was what happens to a lot of fighters, especially guys like Peterson that have been on the high level, and then you get a name no one's ever heard of. Look, I'm Dominican, and I barely knew about Felix Diaz, and he got that shot. And Peterson probably was like, "Man, this kid's nobody. He's a kid moving up from 140. I'm big as hell."
Were you not proud with him in the Olympics? You won gold, you know what I'm saying? Or you don't.
I hear you. I hear. Listen, obviously, I knew Diaz, but we didn't see much of him. Like, I knew he was in Olympic medals. I knew he signed to the Bella. You know, he had those club fights, but we didn't see much of him in terms of casual fans or even most hardcores. I'm from the New York City tri-state area, so I was able to see him more than most. But, like, you know, and again, he was moving up to fight Peterson, who was very experienced, man.
Is he still trained by Joel Diaz?
Felix Diaz, he's supposed to be. And yo, let's be clear, I picked Peterson to beat Lucas Matisse. You know, he just fucking hooked with a hooker, but he's more talented. You know, it is what it is. I never thought highly of Matisse. But Lomachenko versus Sosa is happening sometime in April. It's gonna be happening at the MGM in Washington, D.C., man. We're gonna go, yo, MGM. Really, that's like weird. An MGM in Washington, and now look, we're getting even PBC's doing the Gary Russell fight there first, and then Big Bob Father's.
They passed gambling laws in DC.
What? It's a casino?
Yeah.
Oh, I had no clue. Honestly, you know I'm oblivious to all
that. I'll fact check that, but I'm almost 100% sure that.
Oh, my God. I can't wait then. I'm going to go to that because, you know, on the 11th, we also have David Lemieux versus Curtis Stevens, but that's like 4 hours and a half upstate New York in the fucking Badoonies in Canastota somewhere, right? But, like, D.C. is still kind of the same, maybe 3 hours and a half, but, yo, it's my type of town. You know, they know how to party. Hipster, one day you're going to get to go there, man. We're going to fly you out to the D.C. You can see what a real fight's about. It's going to be like being at – I don't know.
It's 100% a casino.
Damn, that is going to be sweet. I don't want to show my age, but, yo, D.C. is like going to fucking House Party 3, Enrique. But, all right, so we're all picking LP, and we're jumping into this Sosa talk, right? He vacated his title.
Wait. I actually want to give a shout-out to somebody in the chat. They corrected. This is more of a correct thing. It's technically not in D.C. It's on Prince George County, Maryland, and gambling's legal in that specific area. So wherever that is, gambling's legal. So that's the fact.
You know. All right.
And who's the guy in the chat? That's Mr. Mowat, right? Shout out to Mr. Mowat.
Shout out to boxing, period. Finding ways to get it done. I mean, look, MGM for me has always been a flight to Las Vegas, and boy, do I hate Las Vegas. So bringing a fight to DC where I could jump in my little hoopty, get down there quickly, and do this one, I'm happy, man. Then you add in an MGM facility and, you know, a little bit of gambling. I wonder what this thing is going to look like. The boxing crowd in DC with gambling and MGM, I mean, I just want to see it. And Sosa will be there, and Gary Russell will be there on separate dates. But Sosa vacated his title. Let's get to the nitty-gritty here. Hipster, what are your thoughts on him vacating his WBA regular title that he was supposed to consolidate with Jezreel Corrales?
Well, there's multiple ways you can put it, like look at it. One, you can say that, well, he's fighting Vasyl Lomachanko for the WBO, so there's really no point in unifying with the regular title. Like, that's just pointless. So just vacate it, just get rid of the belt entirely. You can do that with the WBA, or you can say that he's ducking Jezreel Corrales, that he decided, I'm gonna go with Lomachanko, the quote-unquote money fight, that's maybe less potential damage because Corrales probably hits harder in my opinion than Lomachanko, and then so you can argue that he's ducking Corrales. You know, it's one of those things where you're going to get people that say he's ducking, you're going to get people that say he's fighting Lomachenko, so what's the fucking point? It's a regular belt. It's not the real belt, you know? So if it was his legitimate belt, I feel like it would be a much more odder occurrence, but it's not an odd occurrence. I feel like it's just get rid of the belt, vacate it. Hopefully the WBA is smart and just doesn't have a vacant fight for that belt because there's no point to it.
Good doctor or casual?
Well, I think that this is a different scenario than like someone like Daniel Jacobs, who has the junior belt, that's trying to, I guess, consolidate the belts and moving up, because they're essentially getting his shot against a legitimate world title, which happens, the route happened to be to drop a belt, right? So it's not like he is dropping the belt and taking a non-title fight. And Lomachenko is the money fight. So he's fighting the best guy in the division for the most money. And it seems like it makes sense, right? It's not really like he's essentially playing a hot potato, right, with the belts. He's not dropping a belt to avoid being a world champion.
It's really hard to say it's a duck when he's fighting Lomachenko. It really is. But it sucks that he's not fighting Jezreel Corrales, because I think Corrales is a fantastic fighter in that division.
It only sucks.
Well, Corrales should have taken that Lomachenko fight, right? Turned it down.
Or Corrales just fought Yukiyama back-to-back and retired him, and Yukiyama is an arguable Hall of Famer. What the fuck are you talking about, man? Come
on. Was Corrales not offered the fight by Bob Arum?
Yeah, we don't know how much.
Okay.
Or was it for 50 grand? That's peanuts, right? We don't know what he was offered, man. Like, yes, there was an offer, but it could have been lowballing. You know that.
But don't bring up the narrative of Yukiyama or whatever the fuck. He was offered the fight. That's all we have to say. He turned down an offer.
Yeah, but he's fought better opposition at 130 than I would say Lomachenko has.
So he's the A side now?
No, but he has a better resume at 130.
Yami.
That is. Who? Ness, can you back me up on that? Does he have a better resume at 130? It doesn't really mean anything.
Lomachenko fought.
Danny Garcia has.
Lomachenko fought Nicholas Walters at 130, and they both moved up for that fight.
Keith Thurman has a better resume at 147, but I guarantee you Danny Garcia is going to get paid more, right? He's the A side. Because he's a better
wrestler. My A side and B side. I understand that point.
Jezreel Corrales retiring Uchi's mommy.
Yukiyama. I don't know.
Uchi's mommy.
Uchi's mommy.
Or the
Uchi mommy, mommy, Uchi mommy.
Or Uchi Wally. Or Uchi Wally. This is how I feel.
Chinese boxing. I have heard that Chinese boxing lacks any real power.
So, you know what's interesting, though?
Japanese, though.
That we were talking about promoters and how Shakur Stevenson signed to Bob Arum and how that's a good move. Here we are with Lomachenko, who is a, you know, gold medalist. Obviously, the boxing industry considers him a star. He's done things that stars do, right? The way that he's moved up the rankings, become champion so quickly. But is this fight in the right place. To be honest with you, you know, it's an urban market in D.C. That's why the Petersons and Gary Russell and, you know, the fight. Look, they're bringing Jermell Charlo. Those are the, you know, that's the crowd. Is there a market for a Ukrainian in Washington, D.C.? Or are they just being typical fucking promoters taking the biggest site fee and bringing this fight into an area where it's not going to do good, a Puerto Rican versus a Ukrainian? Now, here's the other side, though. Sosa is from Camden. He's from Camden, New Jersey. Now, I don't know. Is someone going to argue with me and say, well, they're putting it there, and that's because Sosa's from Camden and he's supposed to fill it?
Possibly. You know, they put people from Philly in New York City.
No, but Ness.
So I don't think you're banking your tickets on the B side.
It's more than that. Obviously, the site fee is a big factor. But I think that Lomachenko, right, even in an urban market, he presents this type of fighting style that he will get attention and he will get praise from even an urban community because he fights extremely slick. He's technical and he has a fan-friendly style. I don't think putting an Eastern European that fights that way in D.C. is a bad move, honestly. People are going to see how good Lomachenko is against someone like Sosa. I mean, we saw it against Walters. We've been seeing it for, you know.
I'm sorry to be that guy, MD, but I swear to God, if this fight was on PBC, they'd be saying, Al Haymon, look at him. He's always fucking up. What, those guys don't belong there.
The difference is that Lomachenko has been fighting good opposition his entire career. And if Sosa happens to be the worst opponent, right? And the location, right? This is the opening of a brand new MGM casino, whatever. This is not throwing people in a Boston arena that, you know, it's an entirely different scenario. It makes some business sense. And it also doesn't make some business sense, but it doesn't seem like a dumb move necessarily, right? Because it's not like Lomachenko demands $5 million a fight and Sosa demands $1 million a fight. So I think that it could be a reasonable venture, a venue. And also let's consider that it's going to be on HBO. And that's kind of HBO. That's where most of the money comes from at this point, right?
I hear you, but I'm just saying to put a Ukrainian there, like, look, they've been putting Gennady in New York for a reason. DC, I think it's like a site fee. Now you heard what I said, so please don't attack me. I love the fight there because I love DC. I know that there are genuine DC fight fans there, and they're awesome. But I don't know. Are they going to come out for Lomachenko? I don't know. They come out for Robert Easter, you know? They dominate that DMV area. All those guys, the Russells, the Easters, there was Warrens, Broner, Petersons, they have notoriously done well in that area. I just never seen anyone else though, you know? So this is a risk maybe, or maybe the site fee is that big enough. I mean, Matt, what's going on? I mean, you always get lost in the chat. What is your thoughts on it? This is supposed to be a hipster topic. Is this fight in the right place? Are they promoting Lomachenko properly by giving him a fight in Washington, D.C. area, or are they just collecting a site fee?
They're collecting a site fee. Come on. You got a Ukrainian guy and a Puerto Rican. Put in New York. You probably have a Ukrainian demographic and a Puerto Rican demographic there, obviously. LA also has a Puerto Rican and Ukrainian demographic. There are just multiple other places that you can fill out. Like, boxing's tribal. Like, as much as we hate it sometimes, like, boxing's tribal. So you have to use that when you promote a fight or a fighter. And the fact that it's just so obvious that you have these guys that sell to these demographics, or at least sell more to the demographics than you have in Washington, D.C., why is it not in that location?
But why are we ignoring site fees? Why are you ignoring it?
What do you mean ignoring? What do you mean?
Because it's not like Vasyl Lomachenko has a Philadelphia or a Miami or a big city. I don't know why I use Miami, but it's just a big city. To fall back on. And yeah,
well,
maybe
yes, he does. That's where you promote. You put him where his demographic or his market is.
But let me. Okay, so I hear what you're saying, but I'm saying is to ignore that opening an MGM arena with a site fee with a decent attendance is a bad move by a promoter. Why? Because you're going to get an extra 3,000 people in the building. Is that what you're arguing? Is that really going to help his career or not help his career? I mean, I'm just saying this is not the type of fight. This is not the type of opponent to risk headlining a big venue that you're going to lose money
on. You don't need a big venue. You need a big market. That's the you can have the StubHub in LA, and that's what, 2,000 people tops, 3,000 people. That's nothing.
Why is that smarter? But how is that smarter than this?
A big market.
But how would that be? Well, what does that have to do with anything? A big market. How would that affect anything?
But I thought that's
you have more media presence. It's easier to promote a fight with the media actually being located there.
I think we overrate that. I think
people overrate that. You're ridiculous. Like if you
No. Hold on. I think a fight at this level
in LA have massive.
I think a fight at this level, Lomachenko Sosa, would not be affected that much either way with a big market or small market. It's going to do reasonable numbers. It's not going
to
be
the promotion. It can. That's the difference.
What MD? What is wrong with trying to build them the way they have built Gennady? It's obviously can be done. Why not follow the same blueprint?
But I don't think he's there yet as far as the numbers and
how is
not just that. No. Ness, what about the fact that Gennady Golovkin is a knockout machine, which can sell anywhere?
Lomachenko is a two-time gold medal winner champion.
Something you have to explain. Knockout like power is something
that
does you
not
see.
Not sell like knockouts.
No, yeah, knockout power is visual. You see
knockout
that
over and over again. You play that.
I love that knockout. I agree with you. I love that knockout. But the thing is, he's not known for that. That's why that knockout was so spectacular.
You have to make him known for that. You air that on every promo. That's
his job to do that. And his job.
No, that's his promoter's job. His promoter's job
has to go in there and promote.
No. His promoter, that's his literal title, is to promote. Yeah. So if he's not promoting his fighter, that's on him.
And someone tell me, how does putting him in DC help when, like, you're saying, well, he's not a knockout puncher. Okay, so him not being a knockout puncher and going to DC does what?
Because you're assuming the numbers are automatically going to be shitty because the demographic. I mean, let's
assume the numbers are good. But if the numbers were good in LA or New York, would that have a greater potential? It
would be better. The numbers would be better is all I'm saying. But
I don't know.
We got one last topic to get to. It's time to switch and move on, open up these phone lines. We've actually ran over our normal time. Obviously, a lot of people went to see Keith Thurman. I'm pretty sure that the world has seen whatever interviews he's done. I know I have definitely been soaking him up. Hopefully, my panelists have run across some things here from us, some of our colleagues, and are up to date on some of Thurman's thoughts. And hopefully, you guys have checked out what we have already released for Danny Garcia and are up to date on some of Danny's thoughts. And I just wanted to get my panelists' thoughts on those thoughts. Let's just use the word thought a lot.
Well, I missed out on all of it. I was just waiting for myself to go up to see Keith Thurman and be fresh. I have no thoughts. I have no thoughts on it. But I did see Angel Garcia being reckless. Again, I just think he should not respond to, press asking him about, yo, why did you say the N-word? You know what I mean? And people got offense and calling you racist. So, yeah, I don't think that has nothing to do with the fight. But
you don't think it's an act a little bit? Like the whole thing you said about Chinese, like it's performance art. Like, he's going with it.
That's disrespectful. That's fucking garbage, man. That is the lowest brow of humor that you can get.
I'm not saying it's highbrow.
Chinese people and that they smell like cat piss.
Was Borat highbrow? No, but it got attention. Nobody's arguing.
Garcia, nah. Like, that's some bullshit.
Okay.
If I'm Danny, I go to my dad and go, you got to shut the fuck up.
Yeah.
You know why? Because when the New York State Athletic Commission, goes in front of him, when Andrew Garcia goes in front of the New York State Athletic Commission, and they go, hey, we're not going to give you a license to train or to be in the corner of your son.
Based off what?
Yeah,
that's gonna happen. They're gonna
based off him saying things that offend Matt.
The New York State Athletic Commission has an obligation to promote and protect the spirit of the sport. Mm-hmm. All those regulations.
Say that with a list.
They have that in there. Look it up,
Matt. So what are they gonna revoke his license based off? What? Tell us.
That he is violating the spirit of the sport. They can do that.
That's not a.
How do you
violate? They find people. They have fined people. They haven't.
I remember something similar to what Matt's saying, that's lawyer talk for having control over anything they do.
You know that. That's lawyer talk. Exactly. Just think about that. Listen, so let's not pretend that the spirit of the sport is being jeopardized by anything Angel Garcia says.
I'm not saying it's lower.
I'm saying the fact that he's playing into the role. Why don't you see that? It's a stupid role.
It's not selling anything, man.
Nobody's saying it's stupid or not. Like, what are you arguing? I'm saying the fact that Angel Garcia.
You were praising it earlier.
Because people like you are offended.
No, people like me. The majority of people are offended.
Danny Garcia is, and Matt, this is what I hate to break
into. When you say Chinese people smell like cat piss, that's offensive, man.
One second.
Danny Garcia is sitting next to Angel Garcia, laughing at it.
He's egging it on. So let's not act like Danny Garcia is going to swoop in and tell his dad to shut up. They're in it together. So let's not separate them anymore. It's their act. It's what they do.
I have to agree with MD. Yesterday, my camera was rolling. You go check out my Danny Garcia interview. And, you know, Angel says some shit like, fuck you calling me a racist. I'm from the hood. And then, you know, you see.
He is a racist. He is a racist. I'll call it. He's a racist.
Matt, you can't. Don't become that guy that cuts everybody off. MD already does that.
One thing I would do.
You don't never let MD talk, by the way, either. You are like the initiator of the cutting off. Okay. Yeah. When it comes to you and he, anyway. But back to Angel, right? Since we're arguing what I hate to talk about, I just want to put out his quote unquote defense. And it was something like, how could the WBC try to take me out of the corner or find me or whatever it is that they want to say, have a conversation with him when they're supposed to be in charge of VADA? They have not heard from VADA. Neither man has been tested by VADA. When Danny fought Morales in New York, he tested positive for clenbuterol, and the fight still went on.
Morales, that is, who tested positive.
Exactly. Thank you, Casual. Enrique underscore church, something like that. So the WBC has fumbled quite a few times to now all of a sudden like try to, I guess, bring down the hammer. It would be impressive if they can do something like that, especially before the fight, but what we must talk about, and that's why it's a topic, is that Danny said he will not have the fight without his father. So people need to really decide. Do you really feel that Angel is as racist as Matt? You know? And you're willing to jeopardize the fight over it because you believe that? Or do you believe that he is the Angel that you've known him to be? And he props up and hypes up the fight. And he might have went a bit overboard, but he's not a racist, then, you know, the fight continues. But I'm telling you, if a ruling gets passed down, they already said they're not fighting.
I just want Matt to clarify his stance, because this is what he's saying. He's saying that Angel Garcia, because he says racist or insensitive things, shouldn't be allowed to participate in
the sport. No, that's not what I'm saying.
Okay.
So I'm saying that's a possibility from the New York State Athletic Commission. I'm not saying I want that.
Yeah, but don't said that they have the responsibility to uphold the spirit of the sport.
Yeah, but
that's
Matt,
not that's in that. Their ruling. That's in the ruling. But I'm Matt, not saying I am saying that. That's in their ruling. They're in their books.
I have a question. What do you think they would do to?
They're gonna give him a big ass fine. They're gonna give
him that's, a that's big all it would be, right? They wouldn't pull. They wouldn't pull
on the wrist and big ass fine.
Okay.
Because let's be real, and like MD is gonna agree with me on this, this shit is just a part of boxing. Like, people have been saying borderline awful shit for as long as this sport has been. Muhammad Ali was calling people Uncle Toms and shit like that.
It makes
that.
So money.
Like, yeah, but wait a minute.
It makes money. Like, these men feed their families with that publicity. I'm sorry, I'm taking that you agree with.
Let's not forget that this is nothing like Sergey Kovalev putting on a t-shirt of a monkey with Adonis Stevenson's face, okay?
True.
This is not that. And no one fined him. He didn't get suspended. No license was revoked. And nor was this type of fucking talk.
Wait, Matt, how is it different, though? Didn't you call Asian people cat piss? How is it different? Why are you angry at Sergey Kovalev?
Because Sergey Kovalev did it to a potential opponent, so it's a little more direct. It's a little more obvious. The racism is a little more obvious. Okay. Like, Andrew Garcia is not the fighter fighting a guy that's Asian calling Chinese people cat piss. You know what I'm saying? Like, it's a little bit harder to see.
I'm just saying, this is the problem I have. This is the problem I have. When you start virtue signaling or evaluating what boxers are saying, whether it's good or bad for the sport, how it affects, I'm just saying that we can't control every
why
single
can't
thing
we say that's racist though. Like, I don't get why we just
you could say that if you want to, but I think you that? But you're bored you it's racist? But you could say that
smell like cat piss?
I think it's a performance act, and I think whatever it is, I think that it makes the sport
more. Take out Andrew Garcia. If person X said Chinese people smell like cat piss, is that racist?
But you know the sad thing is that if you look at my text messages or you hear a conversation I have or you do this or you do that, you take anything out of context, of course things look bad or racist, or it's like any human being, right? That's my point, is that he's literally, it's performance art for him. He's going on. He makes some good points. He says some ridiculous shit. It's just his act, right? And if you look more into it and you dictate your emotions and your values into it, I think that you kind of are just like getting too much into it. It's fucking boxing, bro.
It is boxing. Andrew Garcia is a racist. Like, they're just racist in boxing. That's just a fact.
All right. We've chopped it up, guys.
What if, though, let me say something. What if there's a Chinese judge on that March 4th?
Holy shit. That's what you call a monkey wrench. When you throw a monkey wrench into the mix, that is it just fucks everything up.
That was a good little monkey wrench there, Enrique. All right, so listen, we have gone above and beyond our normal time, okay? So the caller has to metaphorically hit you with at least a Kell Brook 1-2, because that is a very good straight, jab followed by the right hand that he has. So in order for you to start engaging the caller, let them have their call, guys, unless they hit you with... they hit you with something so good that you're forced.
Unless they're on their back foot.
No. Why would the caller? The caller's on the back foot. He's fucking getting away from the pressure. The caller got to be beating you up for you to be like, damn, nah, I can't shut up, Ness. I got to say it because Marcus from D.C. is bugging, talking about Broner would be Manny Pacquiao. That's why you're
forced. Well, I'm about to hijack you right now, Ness, because the number of thumbs up should be increased, right? Let's remind you guys again, hit thumbs up, share. Do all your social media, investments, and keep supporting the Boxing Voice. Just a quick reminder from BoxingMD.
Definitely an investment.
I wish we had the ability and the finances to do some sort of graph and find out how many people actually hit thumbs up when MD says it the way that he does, like that. So cool, calm. It's just like no enthusiasm. He's like, well, you know what, Ness? The number of thumbs up. And then I do it all enthusiastic. I wonder what serves better. Is it MD's quiet, cool little, like almost James Bond voice? It's like, you know what? Hit the thumbs up button, all smooth and shit. Or is it me trying to excite you to hit the thumbs up? Because I never see them go astronomically. I want to see them do 1,000 per episode. That's never happened. Well, I mean, yeah, the Canelo one did, But anyway, let's open up the phone lines. Remember, we do have ringers and boomerangs and true appreciated supporters of the show who will be cutting in line because they paid their little Patreon perks that allowed them to do that. And remember, we always follow the order. So wait your turn.
Well, and one last thing before we take the callers. I think after a few calls, we have to talk about the fight of the weekend, though, in a few calls. But we'll tease that, right?
Fight of the weekend. I don't even know which. Oh, you and
how could you have forgotten?
No. The weekend. That's next week. I'm talking about the weekend.
Oh man, I can't wait for next week.
But what's the week? I mean, the weekend is Broner.
All right. Well, in 15 you minutes,
like the music artist the weekend.
Like, no, in 15 minutes we'll bring that up. Right. Let's get some calls.
Did you hook us up? Did your dad hook us up with the weekend for the fucking CBD appreciation night? I'm a motherfucking star boy.
Wait, Junior. What are you talking about?
I don't know what he's talking
about. Well, I mean, you just blew it. First off, you just...
needed to blow that.
Roy Jones Jr. That's right. He's been wanting to talk about that all day. Hell no, man. Roy is fucking...
Roy is man. Yo, put some respect on his name. What about his resume, Ness?
What the hell is that? You hear that? What is that?
I don't know, but you should put respect on his name because his resume.
Brought to you by our sponsor, El Camino Electrical Services, who have over 15 years of commercial electrical experience, servicing the whole Silicon Valley and the entire San Francisco Peninsula. Visit us at our website, elcaminoelectricalservices.com.
El Camino needs one of those Telemundo commercials where the lights go out and this lady's like, ay, se me fue la luz. No, yeah, El Camino.
He actually wants a new woman. He sent the script. I got to get on top of that. I've just been extremely busy. But Alex has been dying to come on. The amount of messages is, I don't know. Who ticked you off, Alex? What's going on? Australia. Good day.
Hey, boys. Thanks for the show. Before I get into it, everyone thumbs up, share the video. If you can name me one podcast or one show that gives you as much content, as much laughs, boils your blood as this, I'll personally pay you $50 out of my own money. But let's get into it, eh? Everyone knows I don't really agree with MD too much, but today I'm fully on his side. Matt, Jesus, you're out of line today. This is a sport where people die in the ring, and yet you're telling me you're a little bit offended over what Angel Garcia has been saying. Man, everything he says makes me laugh. Like, I belong to, like, you know, like a minority group myself in Australia, and like, you know, anytime I hear jokes or little racist comments, man, I just laugh along with it, roll with the punches, you know what I mean? Like, this is a sport where people die in the ring and you're complaining over being offended, man. Jesus, grow up a little bit, grow some balls a bit, you know what I mean?
I can't be offended by racist comments, really?
But yeah, was that a 1-2 already, Matt?
That was a 1-2.
Alex is a boomerang. Alex is a boomerang. He didn't come back. I love Alex, but like, I cannot personally be offended by racist comments. You're saying that me personally, I just cannot have that opinion. That's ridiculous to have that opinion. I think that's kind of ignorant to say that.
Do you have Chinese in you?
Just like, if you have the opinion that you think it's funny, that you're entitled to that opinion. Just like MD is entitled to his, and Enrique and Ness is all entitled to theirs.
Okay, let's make a bet. Me and you make a bet right now. You said majority of people would be offended. How about you ask every single caller that calls in today, the one question, were you offended by Angel Garcia's comments? And I will bet my life on it that majority of people will say no, because most boxing fans have a thing called...
I'm not talking about boxing fans when I made that comment, though.
Comments.
Just to clarify.
They want to see a good fight, they want to see some entertainment, and that's exactly what Angel Garcia brings to the table. Now to my next thing with you, Matt. This is why I keep disagreeing with you. If you can even just blindly say that Jason Sosa is ducking Jezreel Corrales by fighting...
I did not say that.
A double Olympic gold medalist, a double world champion, world championship gold medalist, two-weight world division champion, who's the money fight and 20 times better than Jezreel Corrales. You've got to be... I don't know if the skinny...
I didn't say he was ducking him. I didn't say that. Alex, did I say that? I said that's a storyline people may have. I did not say that, because how can you say he's ducking someone when he's fighting Lomachenko? Those are my exact words. So maybe you need to listen a little more, Alex.
Rewind the tape.
You can rewind it.
I don't have to. I've been listening this whole time. That's why I've been.
I'm the one that said it, so I remember it.
What you've been saying today, I usually agree with you, but today it's just all MD, which saddens me. You've done this to me, Matt. I don't want to agree with MD, but here I am, nonstop agreeing with him, because you need a grower set, bro.
Bro is set. Okay, when somebody says that your people smell like cat piss and you get offended, Alex,
you thought of your mustache.
You cannot come and talk to me about it then, okay?
There's also something called being so sensitive to racial jokes that you're uncomfortable with race, Matt. Think about that.
He's going to have to use that boomer.
I'm uncomfortable with race? Okay. No, I just don't like racist comments.
I don't know. I just want to say, what's your scorecard, Steven?
Scorecard on what so far?
Matt versus Alex.
Exactly. Where's everybody's wittiness at? What's your score?
I got you, Ness.
Steven?
Oh, dude, that was definitely Alex. I'm sorry, Matt. Ooh, but you
10-9, Alex?
Why let him talk more? He's the caller.
Yeah, but that's the way you were supposed
really
to
let
do
him
it?
Talk, Mr. Cut Jack Phone Jacker?
Well, I took off 1 point for the early interruption. It was a low blow. It wasn't necessary. And
but yo, Alex made the biggest bet. Alex made the biggest bet in, I would say, radio history, I would say, or Boxing Voice history, at least. He's betting his life. So we should definitely take take a poll of the callers, is what Angel Garcia said specifically in the interview today was not offensive.
Hold on, no, very quickly, yeah, just to clarify, hold on, just to clarify. When I said most people, I meant just other people, not boxing fans. Because boxing fans are used to this shit.
Well, you know what?
We're gonna be,
you know what?
More okay or more
the typical hipster does not watch fucking prize fighting. Sorry.
He didn't catch the interview. That's for
sure. Not typical. I'm not a hipster, motherfucker. So back off.
Okay, that's the point I'm trying to make.
Hold on, we're doing the that 2 points. Secondly, I did say that Sosa is not ducking Corrales. I said that's a storyline. That's a narrative people may have. But I did say that you can't duck someone and fight Lomachenko. That's not a thing.
Matt, I don't know, man. I'm seeing 10-7 scorecards in the chat and everything, bro. Shit is real.
10-7.
The chat's brutal, okay? Like, that's doesn't.
Yo, what's the ESPN Twitter percentages, right? Is it like 94-2, and then there's like a glitch in the middle of the undecided, right?
I want to say that the weakest link of the panel was Matt. He was the first one to not be able to, I don't know, bite down. No willpower. He let a couple of – it was just a couple of jabs that he threw at you, and right away – you couldn't hold yourself back.
He said I had no balls. He said I needed to grow a pair. Like, come on. If somebody told you need to grow a pair, you would say something nasty.
Hey, if you equate that to a Kell Brook straight right, you know, I get you, baby. Let's get to the next
one. I will support Matt. And if somebody directly insults you, you have the right to defend yourself, but you went way too long on the defense.
Well, his offense.
Damn, when MD tells you you're going too long on the defense, you know you got to check yourself.
I mean, it was his offense, man. It was like you were in the Matrix the way you were trying to dip around all those shots, man. But listen, let me tell you, Alden from Phoenix. What's going on, brother? Been a while, man.
What's up, Ness? Yeah, I know, man. Listen, I wasn't going to talk about this racist shit, but that's for the birds. But, I mean, where was WBC when Mayweather was making fun of Pacquiao for having slanty eyes? Where was the WBC when Adrien Broner was about to put a video of calling my Najee's girl? Where was the WBC in that? So keep that shit for the birds. Angel Garcia, yeah, he might. Listen, if you were to call him a bitch-ass faggot, they would have said he's homophobic. If you were to call him a bitch-ass surfer, he's against white people. If you were to call, so let's just keep that out. We're talking about boxing. This isn't social justice warriors, all right? Keith Thurman isn't fighting for the black race. And Danny Garcia isn't fighting for the Puerto Rican race in the ring. They're fighting for that belt. That's all that matters. So
Puerto Rican race.
Get off that bullshit.
Yo, bring that shit to Berkeley.
who the fuck is this motherfucker? I'm not even talking to him. Now, Adrien Broner, right? Adrien Broner. Now, his problem was, all right, he's missing weight. Well, he's out for 10 months. That's the problem, Ness. These guys got to stay busy, man. I mean, I was comparing him to Mayweather. Mayweather fought 2 times, and he was the most paid fighter. These guys are fighting once a year. Why is that?
Yeah, because they don't want to take the fights. They don't want to take the fights.
Exactly. That's, I agree with you. That's my point. But this is like these boxers are like, so you guys were talking about Lomachenko. The best way for a fighter to get his name out there, the best way outside of talking about trash, is being busy as hell. You should be fighting 2-3 times a week so you're on TV. I mean, and that helps you not miss weight. So Adrien Broner not missing weight. A lot of it's because he's not disciplined and because he's just unactive as long as he's acting like a bitch. He should be calling Al Heyman and say, I want to fight and I'll bring anybody. I mean, so what's he going to do with Granados? He's going to beat Granados, Ness. I mean, what does this fight do for him? It does absolutely nothing. So he's going to beat Granados. And then Gerald Washington, I mean, come on, man. Gerald Washington is going to have him spinning. So that's all I got, Ness. Peace out, man.
Thanks for calling in, Alden. There was a bit of confusion there. I don't even want to know, but let me know off air. I want to know what took place. 929, are you a first-time caller?
Hold on, Compa. We have Compa.
Oh, okay, guys. Hold on. Don't worry. He's a boomerang. That means he gets to come on twice.
Nobody.
It doesn't necessarily mean that he uses the abilities of a ringer. A ringer is the guy that cuts the line. Yeah. We've just been treating our boomerangs extremely nice because we are appreciative, but Boomerang is supposed to wait his first call in turn, get it on the air live. If he is enticed by one of the panelists or callers to, you know, want to call back in, he has the ability, hence Boomerang. It's not a ringer and a boomerang. I just love the guys.
Ness, do you have to dust off the old parchment that we used to write that very first rule on? Man, I remember that. That was way back.
I mean, it's in my head because thanks to my ringers and Patreons and, you know, boomerangs, life has changed and we're able to cover the sport better, you know. Thanks to them, look, we're all going to be in Florida on Monday, except you, obviously, because you're a workaholic, slave to the man you are. But
wait, Ness, what you don't know, Ness, is that I'm fueling the jet sending you there. That's what you don't know.
Ness, can I just bring up one point I have to? Who are the three biggest boxers in our generation? I guess maybe De La Hoya, Floyd Mayweather, Manny Pacquiao.
Yeah,
definitely.
Which one of them is politically correct and has said the right thing? I'm done the right thing all the time. Which one of them has?
Manny Pacquiao. Oscar De La Hoya does silly shit, but he never says the bad shit. Oscar De La Hoya does silly shit. He don't say silly shit.
Okay, so maybe he doesn't say it, but he does not fit the cookie cutter mold, and he's not.
He was the golden boy.
If anything, he falls into another demographic.
Manny Pacquiao and Floyd Mayweather say what would be, I guess, offensive on a daily basis. And they are the two biggest names.
Now, listen, Pacquiao said some really mean shit, okay? Didn't he say some mean shit about somebody or some sort of, like,
group? He said gay group or, like, animals.
No, I mean, you don't have to repeat. I mean, we know he said some mean shit about a group. So what I'm saying is
he brought up some biblical interpretation of homosexuality.
And no sanctioning body fined him or took his license. So I just don't want to hear people saying that Angel Garcia deserves to have his license revoked for something that is on the same level as MD made clear other superstars have done. This shit happens, man. We got to remember 90% of these superstars come from minorities and then their lives are propped up, you know, in inner cities, their lives are propped up in everyone's eyes on cameras and the mistakes happen live on TV. It's just
all those racist comments should have been fined.
This reminds me of the NFL, right? The NFL. And we'll move on.
Love this subject. No.
This reminds of the NFL, right? That all the rich white owners tried to pass a law that no player, regardless of race, was allowed to use the N-word, right? That's black to black, white to black at all. And that was immediately thrown out of context because they're like, from the players union, they're like, how are you going to tell us how to speak? We can't speak like that to each other. We speak like that from our neighborhoods, you know, into each other. It doesn't offend me. It's not an issue in the locker room, right? And that shows how out of touch they were with reality. And I think, Matt, you're doing the same thing.
No, that's all different. Right. That's not
that's
on
completely
camera,
different because anyway. They're actually employees, whereas boxers are just guys fighting in a certain state getting the approval.
Yo, this show is so passionate. I get you guys, but just let's keep in mind there are a shitload of callers, okay? So let's mix it up with a little bit of us and a little bit of them. And I know what you guys are going to tell me, producers. I know who's there and who's not. Don't worry. 929, are you a first-time caller? Who is this?
Yep, first-time caller, bro.
All right, brother. How long have you been listening?
Probably over 2 years.
Oh, love it. Well, yeah. Thank you so much for being a listener for 2 years now. Obviously, you know the tradition. We're going to play the intro, and we expect to hear an enthusiastic introduction as to who exactly 929 is and where he's calling in from.
Ladies and gentlemen, making his professional debut.
Fighting out of the red corner, hailing from Killer Queens, New York. This is Mike, the man, Josh. What's up, Dr. Voice?
What's up, Mike, the man, Josh? You're local.
Wait. Mike, the man, Josh, yeah, man. I'm going to go ahead and take a stab in the dark and say that you're coming to the appreciation night. This is your first time call, so I didn't know, but that name sounds like an email I might have seen. Are you signed up to come to the appreciation night?
Well, I hope so, because on yesterday's show, you did say you was cutting or refunding things, so I was hoping that my shit got through and I'm coming.
All right, I know I seen that email. See what I'm saying? I'm good with this. But damn, Mike, that's official. First time caller and going to be a first time TBV Appreciation Night attendee. I love it, brother. Now, you've introduced yourself. Now make us all love you, man. Become a caller of the year.
Show up on time.
You're funny. Nah, I just wanted to bust on by you guys because I've been real tight with the judges lately. So I've been doing a little research, right? I mean, I got all my stuff at work now. I do all my research at work. But as far as I've been writing
a lot of the referees, damn, that have been messing up over the years. We're going back, like, to the 90s and 80s. Some of these referees that really shit in the bed with the judging. I don't know if you guys would be interested in that information later on. I'm not saying now.
Yeah, I would definitely like to see that.
And the dude that scored the Canelo Mayweather fight a draw, I believe it was Ford or Ross. I mean, he's got some real bad scoring over the years, man.
He's done, though. I think he said kind of like after that fight that he was done doing it.
I think CJ Ross correct me if I'm wrong, Ness, if you know, was CJ Ross a woman? And was she the one who definitely retired after that fight?
You're the producer. You're going to have to fact check that. But I believe you are right about CJ Ross being a woman.
Oh, whatever. It's like JR Token. I don't know.
And yeah, and I believe I'll double check. I'll fact check. I believe she retired like right Token. After.
You got to remember, the judges are watching.
Well, obviously, he's a man. I'm saying like it's a fucking whatever you call it, a stage name, a writer's name.
No, CJ Ross is a judge, not a writer.
No one's.
He's saying
whatever.
I'm lost. Go ahead, caller. He's Mike Josh.
Is BJ whatever Flores? Is BJ his real name? BJ spelled BJ.
Oh no. Okay, I get you.
Yeah, I like Broner big in this fight, man. He looks like he's playing the part, man. He's in good shape. He's going to sharpshoot this dude, man. When he knocked out Amin, man, he was real tired when he got knocked out. And Broner's got I think he proved he got a real good chin. I think he's going to put the beats on this dude.
Mike, I don't know about Adrien Broner being in real good shape. I mean, have you heard that the fight went from 140 pounds to 147 and now possibly 150?
Really? No, I didn't hear about the 150.
Yeah, man.
Well, that might be due to, I think, what MD just said, or one of you guys just said, having the 10 months off. But, you know, I mean, that's on him. He should have been more disciplined. But you know, he's making me rethink. But I mean, Granados, he's good, but he's not Maidana. He ain't Maidana good. I mean, that's my opinion.
I hear you, Mike. Well, Mike, man, glad to hear you're on board. Finally called in. We do appreciate it. Thanks that, glad to hear that we're also going to be meeting you. You'll be seeing me and Enrique. We'll be having wireless microphones throughout the event.
Yo, Mike, do you for the future, right? Since you said you've been doing the investigation, do you have a current referee that we should keep
with our TBV? Are you not cutting things off?
What?
I mean, we're good, right? Because I did say you were responding.
You're good.
I can't wait.
Matt, I was asking you really quickly, right? With the referee, you said that you've been doing an investigation. Is there a referee in the future, right? Because you know. Callers make statements that we pay attention to some of them. Is there one that we should follow in the future and we could see if your, you know, investigation is correct?
I hear you like saying like this past year, like recent judges that kind of.
Yeah, guys that we need to pay attention to in the future.
Oh, that's a good idea. And I'll get on that.
No, Neil, do you have one off top?
Thanks, man. I got man time.
All right, brother. Well, Mike, you know the email. Send it in there, and we'll definitely air it on the show and give you your credits for doing it. Let's get to some man, Joey. How long has
we
it
got been? A ringer? Hold on, we have a ringer.
That's right. Let's get to Unfaded. Where is he at? I'll find him.
Very bottom.
Way at the bottom. Damn, that ringer really coming in handy. You all the way at the bottom. Unfadable. What's going on?
What's up, man? First time calling in 2 weeks. I've been busy with the new lady in my life, and been going to every single Timberwolves game. You know, we've been fighting for that last playoff spot. So go Wolves!
Ho! You're gonna come on here name dropping, semi name dropping women, and I mean, what nationality is she? I mean, what's going on? Where'd you meet her at? How's you know, she's got you busy with what you've been doing?
Okay, all right, so you ain't gonna cut off my time, right?
Come on, man. It's extra time, baby. Nah, this extra time you're getting right here.
All right, yeah, for sure. So, me personally, I'm Hmong, And then she's Muslim. So we met at the University of Minnesota. So I'm actually applying to dental school, and she's applying. She's actually in med school right now. So, I mean, it's cross-culture dating, but, I mean, she's a good woman, you know. She's a good woman, got good heart. She got good brain, too. So, you know, you got to respect a lady like that.
Oh, who the fuck did that? You – Yo, these producers are vicious. I swear to you, Unfaded, that was not
that was me. That was me. And the reason why is because I resonate with that. That sounds like a similar story to the one that I have, man. So I love it, dude. Keep it going, man. You need that playing 24/7, and you know it. You feel it.
Yo, no, listen. Yeah, I want to know. Brother, I want to know how'd you. I want to know how'd she catch your eye? How'd she get your attention? Because, I mean, it seems like you're wrapped up. Look, I didn't even know. You're fucking, look, dental school, so that's a lot of studying. Plus, you're doing basketball and now boxing. I mean, like, how'd she pull you away from the books and the television?
Well, the thing was that, so we graduated together, like, 2 years ago. But back then, she was, like, hardcore Muslim. Like, she used to wear the headscarf and, like, she used but not wear makeup or nothing, you know? And then this year during Thanksgiving, she moved. So she went to the University of Illinois to go medical school. And then she moved back up here in Minnesota during Thanksgiving. And she hit me up, like, random out of the blue, like, hey, you know, let's catch up. And then when we caught up, you know, I mean, she's like a new person now. You know, she doesn't wear, like, the headscarf no more. It's like
med school will do that to you. It breaks you. It breaks you. It makes you question your faith.
So technically what happened was once she got rid of the headscarf, you was like, whoa, I didn't know you was that good looking, huh?
No, not just that, but it was more like she kind of like found herself as a human being and as a person, you know? Like she found her confidence in herself, because like back then she was like very sheltered and she wasn't like open as a person, you know? But now you can tell like she's grown into a true woman. Like she knows what she wants in life and she's counting herself too, you know. So
yo, Nestor, you've never dated a Spanish girl who started a little late.
Love cutting people off. What the hell is wrong with you?
I'm trying to, you know, add that you've never met a Spanish girl who's a little late to the, you know, the game of dating and whatever because of extremely Catholic upbringing. I'm sure you have. So
it's
the same thing. So there's the same.
All right, but why you? I mean, I'm interested here. You know,
you seem to not understand. So
yeah. I'm understanding. I'm understanding.
No, so like I said, you know, it's difficult, you know, because you know the cross cultures. I mean, she doesn't practice Muslim too much no more, you know, but her family is still like hardcore Muslim, and you know, I'm a Christian too, so it's definitely gonna be hard, you know. But well, she's a good woman, and you know, I'm a good man, and
love prevails really all, Unfaded. Yeah. Love prevails all. Don't you worry about it, man. If it's meant to be, it's going to happen.
Sure, man.
So, hey, hold on real quick, though. When you see, when you watch boxing with her and you guys see like a Muslim fighter versus a Christian fighter, does it get like that? Because we were just talking about how like boxing can be tribal. You know what I mean? Does she root against your fighters?
She's like a supportive like a woman, you know, like she'll watch, you know, but obviously, you know, women, they don't really know what the hell is going on. You know, they like it because we like it. You know what I'm saying? So obviously they're not into it, but they'll watch with you because they want to support their men, you know. So that's good. You know, you got to respect that, you know.
Yeah, and more importantly, good luck on getting into dental school because you know what, investing in yourself is the.
I just took my dad. So I just gotta. You know, I'm just waiting on some replies right now. You know.
And you have hand skills because. You have hand skills.
Yeah. So. Dance skills, hell yeah, man. Come on, man. I got game too, brother. Come on.
No, he said hand.
Hand skills.
Yeah. Hand skills, because I think when I said you're into boxing.
Yeah. No, dental school. No, hand skills.
Oh, for the dental, okay.
Yeah, hand
skills. So I'm faded. We're going to get
whatever, in. You know what I'm talking about. Baby.
We're going to get in, rock the clock, and give us your call, man. But yo, congratulations on everything. Look at that. You know, TBV never ceases to amaze me. Look, we got the good doctor. Now we got the dentist. This is good.
Yeah, for sure, man. I'm going to hit on these three topics real quick. So, if you know, y'all cannot interrupt me, I would appreciate that a lot. For the fight this weekend, Broner versus Granados. If you know boxing, you know, this is a showcase fight for Adrien Broner. There's an old saying in boxing, and there's levels to this game. And Broner, he's better than Granados everywhere. You know, he's got better hand speed, better combinations. He's got better power, footwork, fundamentals. I like Granados a lot. You know, he's a tough kid. He works hard, but he does really have a shot in this fight. And as you guys said earlier, you know, I don't see the Maidana comparisons at all. Maidana actually had game-changing level punching power, you know. If he connected flush with a right overhand or the left hook, you were either chasing the canvas or you would be, like, severely rocked in the ring. Like, your knees would be buckling. Granados, he doesn't have that. You know, he has good punching power and he has good work rate. Like, he outworks guys and gets guys tired. Then he'll get that, like, a corner stoppage, you know. But this fight should be easy for Broner. It'll be a 9-3 decision, so that'll be a 117-111. Second point real quick. Ness, you know, we love you a lot, brother. You work hard for the Boxing Voice. But this last week, you know, I heard you calling Kell Brook a ducker. I mean, I think that's a fanboy take, man. We know you love PBC and the Heyman guys. But Brook versus Spence is happening in 3 months, you know. So if it's happening in 3 months, it's not a duck, man. We know that it took a little longer than it should have, but you got to give Brooke some time. You know, he's coming back from a broken orbital bone. You only got one set of eyes your entire life. You know, if they're damaged, your career could be over, like Margarito versus Pacquiao, you know. And but to me, the true definition of a duck in true boxing history would be like a couple years back when Felix Sturm, when he was the middleweight champion of the world, his mandatory was an up-and-comer back then, named Gennady Godivis Golovkin. And Felix Sturm, instead of fighting Golovkin, he actually vacated the belt and left the division. So that is the definition of a duck. And, you know, Brook and Spence are fighting in 3 months, so that's not a duck, man. And then lastly, I want to give a shout-out to Eddie Hearn. He's showing that he's willing to work with anyone in boxing to make the biggest fights for the fight for the fans and the fighters, you know. He did it with K2 Promotions to do the Gennady versus Brook. Now he's working with Heyman to do Brook versus Spence, you know. And we need all the promoters to put their egos aside and make the best fights possible, because that's what boxing needs right now. We're trying to build a boxing fan base worldwide again, you know. So give Eddie Hearn credit. You know, the guy's working hard, and he's changing the game. He changed the British game, and now he's making worldwide moves, you know. So there's an old saying, you know, you got to respect people who work hard. You know, success comes to those who really grind. So, yeah, that's my call, man. Boxing Voice, you know, stay up, stay grinding. And I'll try to call you guys on Sunday for the review for the Broner fight. All right, okay, everybody.
Quickly before you go, how do you feel about Lomachenko Sosa being in D.C.? Is that good or bad?
I was talking about in the chat. I was saying that Lomachenko, his fan base is not too big yet. You know? So when a lot of you guys are saying, oh, he should be fighting in New York City, New York has a heavy, like, a site fee and, like, regulations you got to pay for. So it's good to go build, like, that small East Coast fan base, like in the D.C. Armory or the new place that they're fighting at, you know. So I think it's good. You know, D.C. is a fight town. ESPN's biggest boxing writer, Dan Raphael, he lives in D.C. So, you know, he's going to be hyping up the D.C. and ESPN fight for Lomachenko. So I think it's a decent move, you know, because if you honestly think about Lomachenko's last fight against Walter, it was at the Cosmos in Vegas, and it only sold, like, 2,000 tickets. So he's still building up his fan base. And we all know how good he is, but you got to build your fan base before you can really draw the big arenas, you know. So Lomachenko, he'll get there, you know, but they're building it slowly, and that's good, you know.
All right, Unfadable. But listen, I still say this, MD, if you want to build the fan base, put him somewhere where his fan base is at. It's not in D.C.
Where?
It's New York. At least bring him to New Ukrainians? Jersey. At least bring him to New Jersey and the New Yorkers. If you at least bring him to New Jersey, the New Yorkers could easily come in a train, bro.
I don't think with someone that's from a country like Ukraine, just like from someone like from a country like Kazakhstan, you cannot rely only on their home crowd. You have to build fans somewhere, and they're trying to do that. It might fail, but
how do you build them in D.C. when the demographic is in New York?
Well, maybe, like I said, did you not hear what I said earlier? That boxing – people in D.C. watch boxing. And if they like boxing, they might see Lomachenko and see he's a good boxer, and they might like him. Is that not a possibility, Ness? Or are you going to be too negative about it?
Possibility, MD.
Negative, Ness. You don't see the positive in the world, Ness. Come on.
Cole? Ho-ho. I hear you, MD. I'm sorry. I don't know. What is wrong with you today? You want to argue?
What up, Boxing Boys?
Compa, what's going on?
What up, Ness, Matt, MD, casual, what up?
Compadre Los Angeles, what's up?
Yeah, I called in to talk about what's up with Madden MD, though. That's what I really called to talk about. I ain't seen no promotion for the fight. Well, where's my 24/7s at? You know, where's my where my face offs at? You know, I want
to. Dude, I'll get started on a press release right now.
Compa, you know what?
Hey,
I told Matt and MD, I said both of them to send me a pic so I could do the face off. And they took forever, bro. By the time they finally sent it, and they sent Matt sent the picture sitting down. MD sent the picture in the plane. I'm like, come on. They don't want to promote this fight.
Sent my picture right after you asked me to send it, Ness. Don't lie.
Their checks are too
I have the timestamp on the text message.
They don't even have a fight poster. The fight's next week. What's up?
I know. It's their fault.
Promotion.
Yo, we got Diva fighters, man. Hey, we got Cotto and Canelo right now, bro. They don't want to do no promotion. You see MD's fucking playing golf and shit.
Hey, we got to get my boy Cotto to be the narrator for that 24/7.
That would be amazing.
What did he say?
Suleiman. Suleiman.
Well, man, I got for my picks this week, I got a Broner and a who walks fighting on that undercard.
Marcus Brown versus Top Dog Thomas Williams and Lamont Peterson versus David Avanesyan.
That's going to be a good one. I got a Peterson and with that Top Dog and Marcus Brown. I'm going to go with Top Dog. But I like Marcus Brown. But that's my call. Good looking out. TBV, everybody, thumbs up. Sign up to Patreon. Matt versus MD, baby. Yeah. Another TBV class.
Yo, man, we got to get, you see, we need that fight poster, man. That's
hey,
not
hold on, Ness. I brought in some facts for the Ukrainian population of L.A. and other cities. This is the 2010 U.S. Census. New York City has a population of 160,000 Ukrainians. Philadelphia has 60,000. Chicago has 46,000. Los Angeles has 34,000. Detroit has 33,000. Cleveland with 26. In Indianapolis with 19. None of those cities are DC.
And you can't find anything more up to date?
26,000 or 26?
No, 26,000.
So what? They can maybe get 200 people out of the 26,000? Like
no. New York City is 160,000.
New York got 160, man.
I don't think 10,000.
And that's in 2010. So that was 6 years ago.
Oh, my God. They all like boxing. They all like boxing.
You can sell out 3,000 seats.
It's not that they have to like boxing, MD. It's that the net would be casted in a closer place to the fish, man.
What do you recommend them doing?
Nothing.
Go to New York.
I recommend us moving.
And do what?
I recommend us
moving. Headline the Barclays Center?
MD, we have a lot of callers.
The theater and MSG.
Oh, my God. These two are unbearable sometimes. Listen, we cannot talk about this every single call. Let's let it go.
Let it go.
Thanks, guys. We have a lot of callers. You guys are bugging over here. Same shit over and over, over and over. Did we get to everybody? We went to Compa. There's no Jose, right? There's no Castle Hill Gill. Make sure there's no Ken. Remember Ken? He's new.
From Castle Hill and wow.
All right. Well, then let's get out to the former WBC champion. Joey, lead off with how long you've been listening and how long you've been calling in, man. Want to see what category you would land under, you know.
Had you shown up.
Joey from Indiana.
Back. I'm here, Ness. Yeah, I've been listening since the Porter versus Broner. I was on a road trip with my wife, and I downloaded the show. So I've been listening then. I didn't call in until last January when Wilder fought. I think when he beat Spilka. That was the first time I called in the show after that.
Oh, damn.
It's been a little bit over a year that I've been calling in, but I've been listening for about close to 2 years. You know what I'm saying? But, man, it's been a good show, man, entertaining. Casual, what's up, man? Matt, indeed. Let me get popping on this. You know, I'm heading out there this Saturday, man. I'm real excited about going to Cincinnati, and I think it's going to be a good card. I'm going to get there right when the doors open, man. I'm going to watch all 10 fights.
Damn.
And my picks, I really recommend for the callers and listeners to go and watch the Showtime reveal that Mark Kriegel did with Broner and Granados, man. It's deep. If you really want to get it in depth view of their lives and what they're going through and just stuff. You know, it's real. It just makes the fight more better. You know, it makes me have a little heart for Granados. I want to root for the kid because he's an underdog. You know, I like underdogs, but Broner's my guy. But I would love to see him do it. He's dedicating this fight to Ed Brown, the fighter that got killed in Chicago. So, you know, that just adds a little bit more to it, man. Lamont Peterson fight, I think that other dude, I can't pronounce his last name good, but I think his first name's David. He looks ready, man. I think he's going to get Lamont. And then Top Dog, Marcus Brown, that's going to be a good one. I'm going with Top Dog by knockout. And then going on to the other topics. Ness, I saw today the interview with Danny. I like it. It seemed like he was doing, you guys had a great conversation, but then here comes his dad again. Like, let the man freeze. Like, you guys had a great interview going, and here this man come in and interrupt his son and take over the whole interview. Like, y'all had a real good shit. So I don't know, man. Just, Angel just rubbed me the wrong way. All I know is after March 5th, we ain't got to worry about that shit no more because Thurman knocking Danny out, and we ain't got to worry about that no more. So that's my call, man. I still wish I was going out there, Ness. Don't get me wrong. I wish I could be there with him, but hey, there's always going to be Thurman and Spence, man. So it's all good.
Yeah, man. I mean, Danny Spence is going to be huge, look at man.
Casual, Ness. Casual's like, Joey, that's why I took your belt. That's what Casual really want to say. It was Casual. Casual over there like, Joey, that's why I took your belt.
He can't say that because he lost it right away.
I did. I did. I made a mistake, man. I jumped the gun. I should have just stick to my script. I would have won.
No, and then, oh, man, there was one more topic y'all had under the after I forget, man. Never mind. I know I got to get going off here.
Lomachenko Sosa.
Yeah, Lomachenko Sosa.
Too late.
I like the idea, man. I like the idea because it's a new venue, man. But y'all be good, and I'll see y'all. I'll call it Saturday if you have the immediate reaction show.
For sure, brother. Glad to hear that people know that the immediate reaction shows would always be here. Because that is something that we were going to continue to do. Let's get out to our new Patreon, 323 Santiago. What's going on, brother?
Not much. Just here. Guys, what's up? How are you? Matt, hope you're feeling well after yesterday.
Uh-oh, wait a minute. What happened yesterday? He got
Yeah, you can't skip over that. You got to elaborate.
Oh, so he got beat up in sparring?
No, I got dehydrated.
Oh!
How did you know? But how did you find out you got dehydrated, though? Did you throw up?
Like, I was just doing some drills. It was about like an hour and a half into the workout, and I just started getting like really lightheaded. I felt like I was about to throw up. I was like, I just didn't eat that much for breakfast.
Matt, are you having trouble making weight? I got to ask you.
I gained five pounds. I'm 135 right now.
He's trying to catch up too quick.
It's gonna be too easy. MD, should I be generous and say that the line should be like 5-1 now based on the dizziness?
Guys, at this point, who's a bigger underdog, Matt or Granados?
I just want to know, like, are you trying to like get in amazing shape to like have like a dancing sparring session, or do you really think that you're going to seek glory?
I'm gonna knock you out, MD.
The real question is: have you ever knocked out anybody?
Anyone?
In your
yes. Oh, yes. Look at the yes. question. Yeah.
And on February 21st, I'm gonna knock you out on your ass in front of your boy Keith Thurman.
I don't know if it's gonna be the. I don't know if it's gonna be the 21st. I think it might. We haven't decided the specific date. I have to work around my schedule because I.
I am not so obsessed with
somebody else that I'm willing to go fly across the country to. Only come to get hurt. It doesn't make any sense.
No, I'm gonna come and hurt you. You don't seem to understand this, man. Like,
Enrique, okay. What sort of lens are you gonna use to record all this shit?
We gotta go wide on this. You know what I'm saying? We gotta do 18, get the corners, and see who's against the rope, and then you know, I'll walk in. It'll be a fixed lens.
Hey, Matt, are you gonna rent out a corner while you're out there, or are you just gonna go all on your own?
Nah, he's got Alex TBB. Don't sweat.
Oh, Alex can help me out. Okay, cool.
Yo, Santiago.
What's up?
So, do you honestly, I know he's your friend and all that. And look, and we're all gonna be friends after this.
Yeah,
does he really have the power to knock an MD type of fighter out? Because no one's ever seen what MD got. For all we know, he could be the fucking next Gennady Golovkin who just decided to be a doctor.
I got to say, it's strange as hell that the odds on this are so drastic, despite the fact that none of us have seen either one of them fight ever.
Well, I've seen MD hit the bag. I've seen him work out next to Keith Thurman side by side in the hot Florida sun.
Yeah, this is all hypothetical theorems. Granados is a headline tomorrow for a reason. Let us not forget what the show is about.
Listen to me. MD is 5-0 in the fraternity. And
that doesn't mean shit.
He and I have been talking so long that he doesn't even know. I still got the video he sent me of him in one of those fights.
Damn.
So if I ever wanted to drop it and fucking increase the line more, I mean, I could just sway it in his favor even more. Just
hey, you should drop it at the last minute before the first bell rings, just to really.
Now that I reminded MD of it, I think he should just give us the HD version of it and really show the world, like, you know, that Matt stands no fucking chance. But I want Santiago to answer the question. You've put the pads on. You've been in the gym. You know, hey, MD, you weren't on this show, but Santiago's already buzzed Matt as well. I don't know if you know that. I'm telling you, the line is, like, you're the favorite, bro. Like, it's like 8-1 because of that. Like, he already got buzzed in sparring, and now he's dizzy. But Santiago doesn't have the power.
Look, I'm gonna put it to you this way. When they get in the ring and they lace up those gloves and MD feels that jab, he's gonna be in for a surprise.
But MD said he's put his head down, head in Matt's chest, and is just wailing away. So how is he gonna use the jab when his back's on the rope?
Because he hasn't sensed my jab yet. He hasn't felt that jab yet.
Everybody,
Deontay Wilder, like jab. He's gonna be just stuck on the outside.
Telephone pole. Tell him, Matt.
You heard Santiago?
Telephone pole, Matt. That's what they call him.
Santiago used the Mike Tyson line. So everybody got a plan till they get hit. Yeah, Santiago, we're gonna start the clock, man.
That's why my game plan is playing golf and drinking whiskey. Actually, last night after studying really late, I even ate Taco Bell last night.
Sounding like Floyd Mayweather eating Taco Bell for Floyd fight week.
Interesting.
Yo, he sounds like Floyd. Floyd was eating Taco Bell one time on 24/7 on fight week. Okay, like, MD.
He ain't Floyd.
Burned 8,000 calories last night.
Did I?
Doing your workout?
Do you?
MD, just confirm, because I've been telling the people, you go to the gym every day at like 9 a.m., right? Every time we're talking, you're like, yo, I got to go to the gym.
I don't go to the gym every day, but
he's being modest, guys. I'm telling you.
No, you know, that's all I'm saying. I'm living my life. I'm going to Tampa, and Matt is obsessing his entire life. I just, you know, just like some people, they set themselves up to be disappointed, and I just hope Matt's not doing that. I really do.
Sad, MD.
I'm
knocked out. I mean, put that video on YouTube for everyone to see, because that was Nessa's promise: is that if you lose, that video goes up to everyone to see. If I lose, it's Patreon only.
But the sad thing is, we're gonna hear you after this happens. You're gonna be like, you know, he was so much bigger than me. He's so much bigger than me. And you know, I was doing well until, you know,
I was golfing. I was drinking whiskey. I wasn't taking it serious. Like, we were just sparring. I didn't think it was gonna hit me that hard. And then, bam! I'm gonna hit you so hard, your ass. Where the fuck am I?
The sad thing is, you. Really, nobody on this, nobody in the world believes you've ever knocked anybody out. Nobody believes that at all. Never, ever, ever knocked anybody out. So for you to say that ridiculousness, and I guess psychologists would consider that delusional. Okay.
No, it's okay.
Delusional.
It's okay, MD, that I've knocked out people. I don't know why you can't believe
in all
it.
Guys
at 118 pounds knock out motherfuckers. So yeah,
if I never met Chuck Latito in real life, I'd be like,
Matt, who have you knocked out?
No. They wanted promotion, they got that. That's it. No more. This is pay-per-view. No more. Marcus. No, actually, it's still Santiago. Jesus Christ. You guys are jackers. All right, Santiago, here goes the clock.
Okay, so obviously I'm going to pick Broner because for me, Broner is the safe bet, but I will not be surprised if Granados comes out and gets the win, because the one thing that I've been saying to the guys, especially during the training that we've been doing with Matt, is
Did we see the Adrian that basically gave away the fight against Porter, you know, against Granados, then I can see Granados winning easily. But if we get the Broner that showed his mettle and grit against Marcos Maidana in defeat, it's going to be a Broner night, easily. So I'm picking Broner, but I will not be surprised if Granados win, and I will happily eat my crow at that point. I am going with Marcus Browne against Top Dog Williams. I am going to pick Lamont Peterson over Avanesyan. My opinion on the whole thing between Lomachenko and Sosa being in Washington, D.C., really it's kind of like we'll see just how popular, you know, Lomachenko can be, because if he can bring his audience with him to Washington, D.C., the same way that Andre Ward brought Oakland to Las Vegas in his first time there, or like the reception that Golovkin got in the West Coast, his first fight here against Rubio, it'll be impressive as far as I'm concerned, you know. And then, you know, I ain't got much to say about the Keith Thurman, Danny Garcia topic, aside from I'm still picking Thurman. That hasn't changed since the fight was first announced. As always, any questions you guys want to ask me regarding any of these topics, feel free to ask. Otherwise, that's my call. Matt, I'm looking forward to seeing you tomorrow for more work.
Are you putting your money on Matt?
Yes, I would put my damn money on Matt.
Are you picking with emotion?
Yes, you're giving those 5-1 odds?
Are you going to do what Freddie Roach does and like literally just buy a ticket and...
I'm just saying, are you picking with emotion, or are you not? Are you sure that your bias, your friendship isn't, you know, coming into play here?
Let me put it to you this way, Ness. There is no way you cannot be picking one or the other without some level of emotion or bias. But at the end of the day, too, just like you pointed out, I've put on the mitts. I've caught the punches. I've sparred with Matt. I've been putting the work in with Matt. I'm confident. When these two get in the ring, Andy's going to be in for a surprise.
Man, you sound like Virgil Hunter right there. Hey, Santiago, thanks
for Matt must have dropped $500,000 on the sparring partner. He got that talent in with him.
Yo, you taking it lightly, kid. When Matt comes out like fucking Sugar Ray Leonard and every last 30 seconds of the round, he's shoe-shining the shit out of you. You bleeding in the corner in front of Thurman. That's the thing.
It's
going to be great when Thurman goes, man, MD, you let this guy beat your ass and he's 50 pounds.
Imagine Deontay Wilder. All the shit you talk about Wilder, he sees Matt beating the brakes off you and your nose busted up. Because you guys don't even know what face Matt, you don't even know it's going to be full face or open face. You're fucked up over there right now. You're at the mercy of whatever's out there.
There's no way that Matt would take off headgear. Don't act like you would.
Ooh.
You want to take off headgear, MD?
No, I don't think Keith will let us.
You would not know.
I don't think Keith would let you guys, because that's kind of
to you and it's under Matt, the,
like, are you guys gonna have really to like, sign the contract?
I'm not joking. And I told Nestor this. If Matt gets hurt, the blood is on Nestor Gibbs' hand.
I've sparred with more Thai guys, so like I've been kicked in the face. God. I've been kneed in the face. Like
callers.
You punching is basic. You're basic to me, MD. Nothing you're gonna do in that ring is gonna be anything I haven't seen before.
How could you say that without ever seeing him? But look, we got callers.
I've seen him against the heavy bag.
The sad thing is, Matt's going to be like, yo, if this shit was MMA, bro, I'm going to pull out my jiu-jitsu skills and, like, I spar with Muay Thai guys. Come on, bro. Just please stop.
Marcus, really, in D.C.
Embarrassing, MD.
Talk to us. Oh, yes, talk to us, Marcus.
Yo, real quick, let me say this. It's not that I think this is a big reason for Bob bringing the fight to the MGM. There are 18,000 Ukrainians in the D.C. metropolitan area. And a lot of times, some of those bordering countries, the higher, it's probably more even just Russian area, Russian population in the area, period, if it's just 18,000 Ukrainians. But in general, D.C. is a fight fan, fight town, and we would go to fights like people go to the movies, you know? So if the fight's there, we're going to go. I think also what they're doing is that they're building up Gary Russell versus Lomachenko 2, which a lot of people around here clamoring for, because the Russells are all out here. And he's been calling for – he said that if he had come up to 30 and get him, he'd come to 30 and get him. So I just think they're building it as another place to have fights like they did with the Barclays. like I said, that where the MGM is, it borders right with DC, Maryland, and Virginia Touch, like right at the same spot where that MGM is. So it, I know I would go. I know if the fight's that close, I'm gonna go to the fight. Period. You know what I'm saying? So, and then there's a lot of fighters here in DC that don't have really venues to go fight. We go out Rosecroft race track and watch dudes fight. Thomas Top Dog had to fight out this. A lot of people had to fight out there until they got on with a promoter. So there's a lot of fighters here chomping at the bit. So if that just opens up, you know, he also, you got to think of Bob got Mike Reed too. Mike Reed's from out here. So, man, he got some people he could put on to probably fill up the arena. But like you said, at the Cosmo, I mean, his, you know, Lomachenko's number is low. Like, how could he do worse than 2,000? You hear me? So, not to mention, that's right beside the Gaylord, and it's a big-ass Changes outlet. So, people who are here in that area, visiting, going to gamble and all that stuff, they'll slide through and go to the fight. We like good fighters. Lomachenko beats the shit out of people. So, you know, most, it's easy to promote somebody that beats the brakes off of somebody. So that's not, I don't think that's a big issue. I think he'll have a good turnout. And that doesn't mean that they will be putting it in what to be the equivalent of the Grand Garden out of Vegas or something. I'm sure they got a smaller venue, probably 5,000, 6,000, a little bit more intimate, maybe 10,000. I don't know. But at some point, it's going to start cracking. Without really having seen Avanesyan fight, just knowing that he's holding that belt, I'm going to say he ain't been in there with somebody like Lamont. If he can withstand Lamont's pressure and keep Lamont on the end of the jab, maybe he can win. But if he can't and this win no good, Lamont going to walk him down and work the body and, you know, win a unanimous decision. If Avanesyan can box, we'll see. Thomas Top Dog and Marcus Brown, who cares? Neither one, all both of them is alpo to the real dogs of the light heavyweight, so it really don't matter. Whoever wins is signing a death sentence to fight any of the top three, B2B, Ward, Kovalev, any of those other dudes. Adrien Broner, his best way to be 140. When he's at 135, he was the biggest fighter in the ring, so he could take the punches. If Broner is sick, like they said he was sick, Granados can get him.
Marcus, you're going to have to upgrade, homie. He always get caught with his words in his mouth. Let me get to Scorsese. Talk to me.
Yeah, Broner. First of all, my boy Alex from Australia. Damn, the thunder from down under. That boy grow some balls over there yet? What's his name, Matt? Matt, you there?
Nah, him and MD going and looking at each other in the mirror.
Man, boy, that motherfucking thunder from down under was, that's memorable right there. I ain't never heard that man. I ain't never heard no Australian person roll somebody. I got to hear more of that shit.
Mundine does it all the time.
Who? Mundine? I don't wish no fucking Mundine. Yeah, Broner. Everybody talking about his chin. Remember, he was in shape when he was taking them punches. He wasn't no loser back then. He wasn't no dude fucking around back then. He was on the mission. You can't be out of shape out here. I know the guy ain't a bigger puncher, but I kind of hope he get upset because he not gonna fight the Bartholomew's of the world. He not gonna fight the Diaz's of the world. He ain't gonna give nobody no shot. So shit, Granados, if he win his fight, he'll probably fight them guys that's really out here grinding for that shit. And I don't know why the hipster don't never mention Bartholomew. He all over Diaz dick every day. I hear Diaz every time I call in. He ain't never won a belt. Why you don't never mention Rances? He won two titles. And he dropped some people doing that. So, Broner, I kind of hope the show come to an end a little bit right here. You know, it been fun while it lasted, but if he can be a joke as a mediocre winner, he could be a joke as a loser as well. It ain't nothing wrong with that, is it? You're a joke, period. Lomachenko and MD, damn, man, like every caller, bro, you want people to just talk about this dude, like, for what? Where he at? He gone too?
MD, for the moment, MD is away. Enrique and Steven are here with me.
Ah, man, yeah, they know to step off when they come to me. They know because it's gonna be some real knowledge thrown around. Thomas Williams Jr. knocking the shit out of what is the boy name? Can't remember. Don't matter. We won't know after Saturday. Will not matter. He getting knocked the fuck. Marcus Brown, he getting knocked out. Thomas Williams Jr. ain't coming to play with him. Going to throw them wide shots. It is what it is. That's my call. I wanted them too, but they dipped out on me. They knew what it was.
Hold on. No, he's got 30 seconds and Matt just hopped
out. Scorsese, you want to talk to me, man? What's up?
I'm no, back.
30 seconds, Scorsese. Go ahead. 30 seconds.
Come on. Go.
I want to know why all this – you can answer when my time up, I guess. But all this Felix Diaz, why you never mention Rancis Bartholomew, who in the same division winning two titles? Like, how – you supposed
he's
to –
he's not in the same division. He's in a division lower.
Adrien Broner ducking both of them. And Granados, I hope he win the fight because he likely fight both of those guys.
Scorsese, Bartholomew is at 135. He took a fight at 140, but he is a 135 champion. He's in the Terry Flanagan, the Jorge Linares, the Robert Easter Jr. division. That's just to clarify maybe why I haven't brought him up with Felix Diaz. Rancis Bartholomew is good. He's just not a heavy hitter. But yeah, that's why I haven't brought him up with Felix Diaz. They're not in the same division.
There you go. Let me get to Alex on the boomerang.
Hey, back boys. I was just going to say, I tweeted at you to give me the link to donate that money to get Matt to the party. You guys didn't tweet it back. I need a link for that or whatever. You guys got to hit me up for that so I can do it now. Just message me or something, Ness. But I don't know if I want my bet on my boy Matt anymore. I'm scared. He might be scared. He might be thinking he might break a nail or something, you know? Or, you know, if... if MD's words can frustrate ya, I don't know what his fists can do, you know what I mean? I don't know, man. You're making me doubt ya. Don't make me doubt ya, right? The odds are good. And they seem to be increasing. But, hit me up with that link. I want to get you guys that money now, and I want this video more than anything right now. I'll be honest, Matt, I want to see you knocked out now for your little pansy beliefs. But
Alex, see, for people that don't know, me and Alex are really tight. Like, we message each other on Twitter. Like, we may disagree on, like, politically and stuff like that. But like, I love Alex.
Egg on Twitter too, by the way. Come on,
you gotta change that up. Come on, man.
You got a fucking egg on Skype, an egg on Twitter. You're just an egg everywhere, man.
I will. Me and Matt are tight. This is nothing but love here. Or joke. We disagree at times, but you know, it's nothing but love. Me and TBV. So hit me up that link in the inbox so I can donate now.
The link is paypal.me/theboxingvoice. paypal.me/theboxingvoice. The boxing voice. All right, Alex, let's get to the mastermind. Talk to me.
Yo, what's good, fellas?
Dre, what's going on, brother?
Not much, man. I'm going to put my picks in real quick. I got Broner by decision. I got Peterson by decision because, you know, I feel the Watson twins might slip some cash to the judges of the decision. I got Williams Jr. by KO. But in regards to the DC situation for Lomachenko, It's a small venue. It's going to hold 4,500 people. So I think it's going to do well down there, man. So Top Rank know what he's doing. They're going to get a couple of dollars from MGM. So I think it's a good look for the D.C. area. It's an up-and-coming area. It's developing fast. So I hope that's a good boxing spot so I don't have to go back to AC anymore after pass over these years.
Yeah, I mean, it's definitely better than AC, right? AC is dead and cold. Oh, it's
garbage.
It's dead, cold, and look, it looks so like, I don't know, grimy.
Yeah, dirty, man. But basically that's about it, man. But look, Ness, have a safe trip out to Ohio, man, and just come back.
Great. Very fast though, I want to ask you a question. Do you think that while DC is not a bad place for this fight, do you think there are better locations for it?
Great question.
Kiev, Chicago, University of Illinois.
Okay.
That'd be a good area because of the European population out there. But that's other than New York, Chicago, and L.A., I think D.C. is a good area. Plus, you got all those government folks out there from all across the world, man. You just never know. And plus, that area where that arena is in a casino, it's thriving. The development is booming outside in the PG County area. So I'll give it a chance. With a casino and new money, you just never know, man. So, I'm pushing for it because I'd rather drive there than go to A.C., so I'll push for that spot to do well.
Me too. Listen, I'm just being devil's advocate, but I love that it's here. Again, fucking Vegas is like 480 for me. I'd rather drive to DC myself.
And you can get a cheap hotel on a Saturday night because all the politicians are gone. So it's a win-win for the boxing fan as far as money-wise. You can take your family out there. get $75 seats and get $150 rooms or cheaper in the D.C. area. Good rooms, because all the Washington heads are out of those luxury hotels. So you can have a really good time in D.C.
Yeah, I wouldn't even stay in D.C. I like to stay, like, in the Alexandria area.
Okay.
But I don't know how far that's going to be from this new venue.
Oh, no. This new venue is north of D.C. So the Alexandria might be a little bit of a, not long drive, but it's out, it's north of D.C.
Mm.
Yeah. It's a good area, Ness. Don't sleep on it. Give it a chance, man. I know you like the Virginia side, but give this side a chance, man.
Oh, no. I'm definite. Again, that's my fight city. Like, I love the way that they love boxing. So I'm going to give it a chance. Again, I was just playing devil's advocate. Is it the right place for Lomachenko?
I'll say give it a try, man. With all those international folks, you never know, man. You never know. Give it a try.
Well, all right, Dre. Anything else?
Dre, are you attending the March 4 fight?
The March 4? Possibly. I'm going to Europe next week. As soon as I get back from Europe, I'm try to get tickets for that Saturday, but from what I understand, there's tons of tickets available still. So I might be in the building. I'll definitely be in the building for Triple G, and I'm going to Turnstone for the Stevenson fight.
Really? Even though Gary Russell's going to be in the new stadium, in the same one that Lomachenko's in, the same MGM in D.C. on the 11th?
No, Gary Russell doesn't have that kind of pull.
April 8th. Isn't there a card April 8th?
No. Gary Russell and Jermall Charlo and Charles Hatley and Oscar Escaldon had a press conference today in the new MGM for their fight that's going to happen March 11th. It was a short announcement, I know. Unfortunately, PBC is infamous for announcing fights 2, 3, 4 weeks out, but that is it. They're fighting the second week of March at the new casino before Lomachenko.
Ruben Guerrero.
I had no clue. I mean, I got a room at the Turnstone and I got ringside seats for $75. So
damn, that's a long ass trip too, Dre.
Yeah,
I hate that trip, man. I hate that trip, bro. I got two tickets taking that trip too.
You got ringside seats for $75, and did you buy that through the Ticketmaster?
That was the highest. That was the highest ticket price, $75 ringside seats.
It's not good.
It's affordable, net. It's affordable. It's almost right. Almost sold out.
It's affordable, but that shows. But doesn't that show that the venue and ticket sales don't really matter because they're not making any money off that fight, ticket sales wise?
Yeah, but that's in New York, upstate Verona.
I'm just saying in general, right? That's just
again, that's another place where a promoter is taking the casino site fee, Turning Stone Casino. So they're like, "Yo, bring that shit over here. We'll give you a bunch of money."
It's a small arena. It only holds 3,700 people. It's a small arena. It's like a ballroom. So
that was Triple G's first U.S. fight. That was when he fought Proska. I went to that one.
Yeah, man.
Were ringside seats $75? I've been to small fights.
It's always cheap over there, MD.
No, that's the cheapest I've ever heard.
No, it's really cheap over there, and it's very, you know, like every seat is good. They have a balcony and everything, like a second floor, and that's good too. It's a great spot for fights, great spot. Listen, Dre, let me get to some others, brother. Thank you for calling in. Dre, man, you sent me the link, and I don't hear you saying you coming through.
My money's good, brother. I'll be there.
I mean, I'm not saying your money ain't good. You know I know your money's fucking good. You're Patreon. You're mastermind. I know your money's good. I'm saying, you know, you got all these trips. You're talking about Europe and shit. I wish I could be traveling like that, but you're always traveling.
I'm trying to get you to Sheffield, brother. We need to start a GoFundMe account to get Ness to Sheffield for Spence fight, man. We need to get you to Sheffield, brother.
Yeah, man. I don't even want to do it just me. It's got to be a group thing, man. We've been talking about it, man. It'll be like a $5,000 thing to get the whole team. I mean, MD's got to go. I don't want to, you know, it can't just be Ness, man. I know that I do put in a lot of work, but look, this group of guys right here they've made TBV the best version that it is. And if TBV's going to go, it should be all of us. I mean, we just got to push that Patreon, man. Once we reach that, all we got to do is reach 50% of our first goal, and we can make the trip ourselves if we get to Patreon on point. But, Dre, wow. I mean, from your lips to God's ears, you already know. Let me get to some other callers here. We went to Santiago. It's time for some alumni. Appreciation Nights going down March 3rd in the Soho area. DJ Hollywood from SiriusXM and Hot 97, Enrique Church, aka the Casual Fan. You know, you got Matt the Hipster. He's going to be coming off a huge knockout of BoxingMD. I mean, Ness is going to be in the building. Deontay Wilder, Austin Trout, Willie Monroe Jr., Julian Hammerhands, who's sparring with Danny. So the day before the big fight, you get to ask the sparring partner all types of questions. I mean, it's going to be everyone. The effing vodka sponsored the event, so drink all you want. Hopefully we get a shitload of bottles, we turn into Oprah, everybody gets a fucking bottle, Enrique gets a bottle, his girl gets a bottle, we even sent a bottle to BoxingMD over there in Gainesville. It's gonna be crazy. Listen, let's get out to some callers, and one of those are a nominee for Gypsy King.
Mr. Info Joe.
Tell them the truth, girl.
This portion of the show we call In the Know, presented by my brother.
What's up? What's happening, fam? What up, Matt? What up, MD?
Uh-oh. Don't tell us Blog Talk is messing him up. Well, it sounds that way.
Hello?
We hear you, but you're going in and out.
Yo. I don't know what I've been sounding choppy from the before I had called in. You.
That sounds horrible.
It does?
It does. Yeah, I mean, every other word is paused. No clue what that's about.
Yo.
Let's try someone else. Info, we'll come back to you. Hopefully, you know. Wood, are you there? Oh, shit. Must be the system, guys. Let me see. Stainless. That's going to suck. All these calls.
Yo, what up, dog?
What up?
Yo, what up, dog? Can you hear me?
Oh, we hear you loud and clear.
Can you hear me?
We hear you.
Hold on. Let me make sure my speaker off and everything. Yeah, what up? You can hear me?
I hear you fine.
What's going on, Ness? You know what I'm saying? Casual. Steven, Matt, MD.
Full house, baby. We happy.
You know, I'm going to make the same picks that everybody else is. Broner, Peterson, the top dog. It's going to sound weird, man, but I want to give a vote. I don't know if I can cast a vote. I don't know how to cast a vote. But I want to cast my vote for Caller of the Year and Prospect Caller of the Year for Marcus from D.C. My man is just so on it, man. It's like Info Joe, who unfortunately got cut out, but I appreciate every call I get from that man. You know, I agree with him on the DC thing. You know, I think that's a good move for Lomachenko because his numbers aren't built yet. Why not move around while you're still building your fan base? And I mean, other than, you know, those two or three other spots, there's nowhere else for him to really go. So why not bridge that gap for the DC base so that when you do the New York venue, maybe you'll get some DC people to drive out there just because they got to see you in DC. That being said, man, I'm with Compa, man. I'm excited about the Matt MD fight. Matt, you there?
Yeah, I'm there, man. What's up?
All right, man. Yesterday when we was doing the TVV nominations, after I got off, you were saying, like, how stuff's Kendrick. You want to talk about Kendrick? Man, I couldn't wish for anything greater in this world than to see MD get knocked out. You know, that's. I know it's just sparring. You know, I don't want to get, you know, this, that,
concussed.
You know, what's his name? It's Latisha and knockout. But I'd like to see him get knocked out. And it just so happens that y'all are fighting on my birthday. So, you know what I'm saying? That just might be the.
Oh, I'm doing it for you, Marcus.
Working yourself in, bro. So. You, man.
Well, we don't know if the fight is on the 20th.
Do it for all of us.
Do we?
It's not even on the 20th. I'm flying in. Do it on the 21st.
Yeah, the 20th, we got to build it up. They got to face off. You know, it's the press
conference. We got the weigh-ins on the 20th. Got the press conference. You're right. You're right, casual.
I don't even know if I could do it on the 21st. I have to look at my schedule.
Oh, A-side speaking.
I'm not talking.
A-side, that's right. You
no, gotta- I actually have a life. I don't fly across the country because I'm obsessed with somebody that can't beat them with words.
I beat you with words all the time on the show. What the fuck are you talking about, MB?
How many people besides this last hipster dick rider that just called in Stainless has agreed with one thing you've said tonight? Just wondering. Because I'm pretty sure every single caller has pretty much
– You know me or something.
No, that was
– I'm just basing what I know off the last call.
Intensely personal.
It's okay, MD. You're triggered. It's you know, it's okay. We don't need safe spaces like you sometimes. It's okay, man.
Stainless, that was your call, though. He caught you with a shot at the end of the bell, man. Wood, you're back.
Wood.
Second.
Oh, man, again?
I don't understand. Why is it certain phone numbers?
Yo. Hello?
Yo.
Can y'all hear me? Can you hear me?
Yeah, I hear you, but there's something wrong with the system, hey. I believe. Spit it out.
Something was on the system yesterday, man. My shit keeps fucking up, man. Hello?
Yep.
Y'all hear me?
Yeah, but you're breaking up, man. The system is down, man. It's not cooperating.
Joshua from New Orleans.
No, just let him fucking talk. Just let him talk.
But it's kind of annoying.
No, just don't say anything. Not just us. Let him talk.
Look, Joshua's phone sounds fine. I don't know what the fuck is going on with his phone.
He needs to stop using burners. I don't know.
Yeah, hello?
Yeah, what's up, Joshua?
Let me. All right, this is a pretty good topic. Adrien Broner and the other cat, Adrien
Granados.
Hey, this pick for this dude telling me the fight off Adrien Broner beat him, but I'm going against Adrien Broner. I hope he lose. I lost faith in the dude. He's not disciplined. I think his time has came and gone, honestly. I'm really getting tired of him. You made reference towards the Lomachenko and the Sosa fight. I won't get it straight about Lomachenko. I like the dude as a boxer. I think he's very, very talented. But I don't appreciate the hype he gets for the complexion of his skin. And that's pretty much what it is, and that's why I will go against him.
I missed that. Who
what hype? Like Sosa.
Wait. Who's getting the hype for the complexion of the skin? Lomachenko?
Lomachenko.
Broner. He's talking about Broner.
He's hype for the complexion of his skin. And that's why I go against him, and that's why I'm going to continue picking against him, because...
You talking about Broner?
Before I come around... No, I'm talking about Lomachenko.
Oh, because Adrien Broner is pretty hyped, right?
I've been saying he's been a hype job. I say his time has been
okay.
But let me finish talking about the one you dig right. Lomachenko, for starters, they got a bunch of fighters like Rancis Bartholomew, like somebody was mentioning earlier. When he sees fighters like that, he's going to lose. And I put up anything against anyone saying Errol Spence.
If he sees a dark-skinned fighter, is that what you're saying?
Before ever lose his next fight.
You're saying if he sees a dark-skinned fighter, right? Because you're picking against him because he's white.
No, I didn't say that. I can explain what I'm saying. Don't chop up my words. I'm saying I don't support him like everybody else do because he get that first white class hype. Because he's a white boy, basically. That's what I'm saying. If he wasn't hit the color of his skin, he wouldn't get the hype he got. And he already got his ass whooped already anyway.
Two gold medals does not deserve height. Is that white privilege?
Yeah.
Two gold medals. Yeah, it is. Come on, man.
It is. Man. It's all white privilege. Everything, right? Gold medals, right? Everything.
Oh, it is.
Yeah. Ukraine is Beverly Hills. He grew up in Beverly Hills. He grew up privileged, right? Do you see how ignorant you sound?
Oh, man. Come on, man. Hey. Let me finish my call, man, for starters. Like I said, I respect the dude as a boxer, but he get that first-class white hype that he get for the complexion of his skin.
That's what it is. So I'm always going to go against him. And like I said, he's going to lose a fight before Errol Spence Jr. lose a fight. And I'll bet you anything on that, MD. Like I've been saying for the last past calls. And like I said, that's all my calls.
Bet you anything, I'll bet you $100 right now, Kell Brook's beating Errol Spence.
Ooh. What?
I'll bet you $100 right now that Kell Kell Brook is beating Errol Spence.
Kell Brook is beating Errol Spence.
That's a good bet. For MD.
Yo, Joshua has been calling in at least consistently this year, so I guess it's safe to take the bet.
Is he taking that bet?
He said he's taking the bet.
Okay.
I bet you Lomachenko lose a fight before Errol Spence lose a fight. Do you take me on that bet?
Yeah.
Yeah, but you would lose.
Wait. I gave you a better one because I think Errol Spence is losing his next fight.
Lose another fight before Errol loses this fight.
Yeah, he's losing his next fight.
So he's betting you that Errol Spence will lose.
No, not next fight. I said Lomachenko going to lose again before Errol Spence Jr. loses his first fight.
And you don't know what I'm saying. I'm saying that since Errol Spence is fighting Kell Brook and I think Kell Brook's going to win, I'm saying that can't happen because he's losing his next fight.
Lomachenko is fighting Jason Sosa next. Kell Brook is fighting Errol Spence next. He's saying Errol Spence is going to lose that fight.
I know Errol Spence is losing the fight. So, well, I mean, I bet you on that. What you just offered, will you take the bet that Lomachenko will lose a fight before Errol Spence loses a fight?
So that's $200.
Yes. I'm taking $100. Yes.
Lose another fight.
All right. So he took the bet. Okay, listen,
I got you on that one too.
Listen, but you know, I don't want to offend anyone here, but you know. I think that
he's betting twice.
This bet should be some sort of kitty. You know, we don't want to be hunting anybody down come May 20th. You know what I'm saying? So the money should be held there and the winner gets it instead of wait for the fight to be called and then expect for the loser to pay. We've been in those situations with other as bettors, not calling you that. We're just looking out for ourselves and trying to avoid a problem.
People still owe me bets, just letting you know.
That's the point. And I don't want to be making bets that then they don't get paid.
We have his information. We can work things out. We can get on to the next caller.
Exactly. I'm not saying that you're like that, or Joshua, but we do have to, take precaution. That being said, you did have your 3 minutes. We will move on. We can at least vouch that he's been calling in very frequently. I mean, you're live.
Yo, what's good, fellas? What up?
Chill out. I mean.
Yo. Listen, that MD Matt fight, that's going to be a pretty good fight. I think somebody talked about the promotion earlier, or lack thereof, and it got pretty heated, man. I think that's going to be a pretty good fight. My money's on MD. I think I'm going to try to put some bread up for the trip to Sheffield when we get that popping. Jason Sosa Lomachenko, I don't know, man. I think it's possible that people could be ducking Lomachenko. And I think it's one of those things where it might be, you know, they're holding it in D.C. They're just trying to spread him around a little bit. Maybe they don't have really a trajectory in terms of what kind of fighters they got. So somebody mentioned earlier about Russell and Lomachenko, so building it up in that area, you know, building Lomachenko up in that area to make it a bigger draw. So I think that's a pretty good, whoever said that's a pretty good point. I'm going to go ahead and make my picks. I think Adrien Broner, not for nothing, I'm tired of him, yo. I think he is not the kind of fighter that can adjust in the ring. So for all the talent and the potential he has, he's still flat-footed. He still don't have no head movement. He doesn't have enough discipline to make weight consistently. And, you know, as talented as he is, I don't really see him really being able to compete with some of the, top guys. So I'm picking him anyway over Granados, but this fight doesn't prove anything to me. I got Peterson. I got Marcus Browne over Williams. And I got Roy Jones over Dunn.
He actually picked that fight. Oh, I mean, I love it, man. Yo, MD, that had to make your day. MD, hey, about that shit all day.
Yo, like I said, how hilarious would be if you had to eat crow, though? Like, oh my god.
Yo, but that's the resume. Like the thing you say, you got to put respect on the resume, right? Roy Jones Jr. has probably one of the best resumes in boxing, doesn't he, Ness?
I mean, he does.
Yeah.
Oh, one more point, fellas. Let me see if I can sneak this in. Ness, you know where we from? Like, if you're Dominican, if you're Puerto Rican, if you're Black, if you grew up in our neighborhood, and I'm not giving Angel Garcia no pass, but if you grew up in our neighborhood and your parents, we all work in the same neighborhood, and that Puerto Rican, that Dominican say, yo, what up, my nigga? That's what it is in that neighborhood. That's how they do where we from. And Black and Brown maybe is a little bit different on the West Coast, but that's how we do on the East Coast over here. So I'm not giving Angel a pass. And it's still an ignorant mentality to stand up there.
Hey, I mean, very fast. Don't you think it's okay to say that in private, but in front of a camera, it's not okay?
Who's worse, MD or Matt?
I wanted to ask him a clarifying question because I love Amin's calls. I want to hear his opinion on it.
Happy that you asked that, Ness, because I've actually been keeping a tally of who has been interrupting who the most.
Oh, my God. I love you, Steven. God, really? Please get us the money to give this guy full time. Who's fucking winning?
Do you want to know now or at the end of the show? Do you want to know
Ness,
now at the end
Ness
of the show?
Ness is winning, right? Come on, Ness is interrupting.
No, Ness isn't winning. No.
Tell us at the end of the show, because now that they know, they probably are going to be on their P's and Q's, hopefully. Jeez, let's get to, I wonder if this CT from Connecticut, 860, first time calling in, CT from Connecticut, who's this?
Yeah, CT, what's going on, Ness?
Damn, long time, my friend. Glad to have you back, brother. How are you?
Good. Thanks, man. Thanks. I got your number from, matter of fact, I think it was on Facebook. I think so.
That's
a new number.
With the Boxing Voice number or
direct number? Yeah, no, it switched. The call-in number did switch a couple of months ago because of the system, but glad you found it, brother. Save it. Talk to us.
Yeah. I just want to talk about this weekend's fights. I'm going with Broner, just mainly because I think Granados has he punches with a lot of volume, but I don't think he has the power to hurt Adrien Broner. I think especially on the inside, I think Broner will get his shots in, those uppercuts, and his quick combinations, and I think the weight will have a big part in the fight with him going up in weight like that.
What about that Marcus Browne and that Thomas, that top dog Williams fight?
Yeah, I'm going with Marcus Browne, just mainly because Williams has been, the last few fights, he's been in some wars, especially that last fight with Stevenson, that dropped like that. I think he's been through too many wars the last few fights, and I'm picking Browne by decision.
Then we got David Avanesyan versus Lamont Peterson, also on the card.
Yeah, that's going to be interesting. I want to see how Lamont looks at 147. It's a close call. I'm going to go with Peterson just because he has the ability to adjust a little bit better in fights.
And your thoughts on Lomachenko's fight is going to be in the Washington, D.C. area in the new MGM Grand Casino. Is this the promoter taking site fee money, or is there a possible market for Lomachenko there?
It's a possibility for marketing for Lomachenko just to see where he could do at different venues. I think it's a smart move, to go to different venues and see how his marketability stretches out from there. I think it's an interesting fight, too.
Last but not least, do you consider Angel Garcia's comments racist?
No, not at all. Especially like me being from the East Coast myself, too. It's just how people talk. I think he got caught up in the moment like always. You know what I mean? It's just how we talk to each other on this side of the country. So, no.
So you call Chinese people cactus over there?
Yo, this guy. Yo, mark him down, Steven. Mark him down.
I'll take that one. I'll take that. So in the East Coast, do you guys say that Chinese people smell like cat piss? Is that just socially acceptable over there?
No,
it's not. Okay.
Cool. You know what we do say though, and this is offensive, that Chinese people do, cook rats and dogs. We do say that. And we do say that Chinese restaurants are bulletproof. We do say that. Yo, you went to the bulletproof spot or you went to the one on Bloomfield Avenue? You know what I'm saying? That's how we speak. So
I don't well, CT, man, we do we have transitioned a little bit since the last time you called. We do give everyone one round to talk. The bell has rang. We want to thank you for calling in. Please don't lose the number. We have producers now. We will remember you. Obviously, I remember that 860. That kind of sucks in a way. It's like bittersweet. Oh, shit, 860, it's CT. And at the same time, it's like 860 is always CT. Where the fuck is Connecticut at? Stand up!
Hey, Matt, do they have bulletproof Chinese spots on the West Coast?
What do you mean by that? Like, they're literally bulletproof?
Like, the Chinese store has the...
divider, plexi thick for bullet prevention.
Well, I mean, like, you have, like, parts like, of town.
You mean, like, a regular grocery store? Like there's, like, a market? There's a market? Regular, like, yeah, does a market have a...
Yeah, no, it's like that because I went to a taco spot in Vegas that was like that, bro. Like, bulletproof glass on the taco.
If they're in, like, strip malls next to a panaderia, yeah. Then, yeah, they do.
Like, almost like flea markets.
Yo, isn't that offensive to you? Like, they're looking at you as if you're going to rob them. That's extremely offensive.
Yeah.
No.
Yeah. Why would?
Oh, yeah. It's offensive that if you wanted to, you can't have the security you want, right? That's offensive. Yeah,
it's offensive to assume that there's gonna be crime.
A little bit extra. It's like I'm gonna put up bulletproof.
Because you can have restaurants without.
You know what? I'm giving us all one point right now because there's still a bunch of other calls we could be getting.
All right, go ahead, man. I just wanted to bring that up.
All right, let me get back out to some callers here. CT, thanks again. We got Alex Lemon in the chat. Yeah, when is Enrique gonna finally do that intro for you, Alex?
It ain't Lemon, is that we got London in the track.
No, but his name is Lennon. Lemon. That's why you're supposed to do the intro with London in the chat, weirdo.
I'm gonna have to do this one. Like, yo, ladies and gentlemen, give it up for Lemon.
Nah, I want that easy beat, man.
Which one? What, American Gangsters?
Yeah, that certified gangster we spoke.
Certified gangster one?
Yeah.
Yeah, something, you know what I mean? Hail Mary, Machiavelli, Hail Mary. I'm from that West Coast.
I like that.
That was nice. Hell yeah. Hey, 180 versus 135. This is a mixed match. Is that a fair statement to make?
Definitely. Definitely, but it's not a cherry pick. It's not a cherry pick if the 130-pound guy is the one axing for the fight, right? That's what Kelberg did to Triple G.
I was going to say Triple G, they call that a cherry pick when he fought Khan.
But not guys like MD and all the other Triple G fans.
Oh, man. I don't know if you want to call it a mismatch or a cherry pick, but it's definitely out of the weight divisions, man. I didn't know it was so far apart. Matt, I'm still going for you, but man, the odds are against you, bro.
It's okay. Some people are going to bet against me purely because of the weight. It's fine.
I just want to tell Info Joe that neither one of my two producers reminded me that I said I wanted to go to you next because your call wasn't working, Info Joe. So just know that Matt, he's so busy, obsessed with MD that he's not even remembering you.
Hey, real quick, I'll do my picks. I'm taking AB. I'm taking the fake Swift herd. And then I'm taking Brazil.
Yo, wait. Swift Herd is next week, buddy.
Is that the last? Oh, you're right on the undercard of Deontay Wilder. You right. My bad. But I'm still going to take the fake Swift. So then, I want to take that other guy, Avi. I can't pronounce his name, but I do Avion song or whatever. I'm going to take him because I can't stand Peterson. I'm going to go with the hard on that one. And then about the whole racism thing, man, I can't believe that they're going to try to take his Danny Garcia's trainer away, man, because then you're going to have to take Mikey Garcia's trainer away. You're going to have to take Sean Porter's trainer away. Are they going to do all that?
And they're not going to do that.
Nothing happened to him. Yeah, they're not going to do that. And what about AB when he was talking about Mexicans, Puerto Ricans? He's naming all these races. And that didn't sound derogatory, or Koblet wearing that monkey on his shirt. That's racist like crazy. So, and And I got a question for you guys, man, because you guys are from the East Coast. Can a Puerto Rican use the N-word and it not be derogatory?
I mean, you hear the callers. Callers are calling from the East Coast saying that they accepted Lemon. You know.
Have you ever heard of the rapper Big Pun?
Exactly.
Have you ever heard of Fat Joe?
Don't like.
Do you see people? Do you see people knocking on the record industry, being like, "Fat Joe, stop using the N word. It offends me." Nope. Never heard of that. First, never.
Some people, hey Alex, that's your call. You know, some people did get offended at J Lo, but I quickly defended her, man. You know, listen, I had a long conversation with someone today about this, and I think that it is more about where you're from. Maybe the West Coast is different, you know, because the person I was talking to was from Seattle, Washington. I mean, he did say that he was born on the East Coast, but he also was raised in Washington and Cleveland and Florida. So,
yeah, you know, they get brainwashed over there to not realize that people that have people.
No. Let me talk about that brainwashing shit. The fact that we don't.
Producer, he doesn't let me talk. You hear this?
Chinese people. That they smell like cat piss, that we think that's not okay, that makes us brainwashed. Get the fuck out of here, man. That's called human.
The point I'm trying to make, let me talk. The point I'm trying to make, and you should, one second, and you should listen to this and take it in, is that people who actually have friends that are different races, we fuck and joke around with each other. So we're not so uncomfortable. We're not so uncomfortable when we hear it on camera that we cringe the way you cringe. That's all I have to say.
Steven, what is the count on the amount of times that Matt has used the term cat piss?
I would say about a third of the times that he has interrupted anybody. So about five times.
Damn.
I've never even heard that as a derogatory term. That's a new one to me. Maybe I should use that, right? It's a joke.
Info Joe. No, it's not. Let's get to Info Joe.
I always thought that was like terrible.
Joe,
yo, how it sound now?
See, now you got a good connection, brother. Yeah, you're clear as day, man. Talk to us.
Hey, how you doing? How you brothers doing? What's up, Matt, Steven, Casual, MD. MD, I hope you're getting ready, bro. Because Matt gonna put an old-fashioned lash and ass kicking on you, man. I can't wait.
Yo, remember, he's also a trainer, though, Matt. These guys are all biased. They all training. They all training Matt, MD.
Hey, put me down for Lamont, top dog. And you know what? I was on the fence with this Adrien Broner and Granados. First of all, I was picking Broner, but after hearing about how he's not making weight. And I went back and looked at the Amir Imam fight with Granados, and Granados averages about 80 to 90 punches a round. Broner's best output is maybe 30 to 35 punches a round. So I'm picking Granados for the upset to outwork Broner. I like Broner. He's good for boxing. He brings the entertainment. But I see he got some slacking in his macking, man. He's not taking it serious. He put all those fucking videos out about how he changed and
I'm sorry. I gotta say you got some slipping in your picking because I also watched that fight with Granados, thinking the same thing. I fell into that same hype and I was like, you know what, then I saw Granados' resume and the fight before that, and I'm like, man. You know, I was hype off of the Amir Aman fight, being that, you know, he beat this guy that had a lot of momentum behind him. And now he's fighting Broner. And Broner is just more angles, has all kinds of angles and has flashy, fast punching, where Granada was just wide open all the time and paced at a timeable pace. So, yeah, man, you slipping and you're picking, pimping.
I don't know. I think he being the casual on this one. No, but most of y'all picking Broner. And you know, in conventional wisdom, he is the more talented fighter. But yes, he's not on his A game. And that's doing that shoulder roll shit that Amir Imam tried too, it's not going to work. He's taller than Broner. He looks bigger than Broner. He's going to be punching down on Broner.
And that's why Broner's going to look really good. Go ahead. That's why Broner's going to look good. And when I saw the face-off and I saw those same comparisons you just mentioned, I was saying, like, damn, man, Broner's stepping up, man. We got to applaud Broner. He's fighting the best that can face him. But then I looked at resume and looked at the fights, and then on paper and on video, it just gave me a whole different story, man. This fight is going to make Adrien Broner look damn good.
Ain't no TBV party without Info Joe. Joe, thank you for calling in. Shout out real quick to my newest Patreon. Just came through on a check-in. Sal, thank you for joining the fam. You know you're part of it. Let's see. We went down, man. We got the Alex. We going out to the – we had Gerald Washington. Now we got the corner. Donald from Richmond. Talk to us.
Hello.
So, I know you're just getting out the gym with Gerald. What you seen over there in Pullman's, man?
Man, you crazy, man. You know I got you know I'm gonna put it to you this way. Obviously, a lot of people saying, "Oh, the fight ain't gonna go five or six rounds." The thing is like I look at it this way. If he get in there and he do good. I mean, do most people think he's going to win? No, nobody thinks he's going to win. But I told Gerald just like this. If you can go in there and you can last the 12 rounds, that alone makes a name for you there. You would be the second opponent that he couldn't get out of there, you know? And then if you put up a good fight, that would be your first loss, and it's only to the WBC champion. It's not to nobody else. So, you know, you still got some time to do some stuff. I'm not gonna stay on the subject of that.
That's a bad state of mind to say, yo.
I'm pick my
12 rounds. No, you got to go.
I want to see this fight. This MD and Matt. MD, you want me to train you? I'll train you for the fight. Since nobody's offering no training, it's like everybody want to train Matt. I'll train MD.
Is this Gerald Washington's trainer?
What is it? What?
We got Doomsday flying in, man. He's
wait, is that Gerald Washington's trainer for real?
Yeah, this is Gerald Washington's trainer.
No, I'm not Gerald Washington's trainer. No, I'm not his trainer, man. He's saying that shit because Gerald is my boy. You know, I know him. You know, we used to go to school together. That's my partner. And he's just, you know, he's just making a joke out of it. I'm not really Gerald Washington.
I'll be saying, yo, at least if you go 12 rounds, I just start again. Extremely doubtful in the team.
Well, the thing is, if you look at it like that, when the fight, you know, people say he's going to get knocked out. And I think that if you go in there and it becomes to be a tough fight, just go in survival mode and last the 12 rounds. And that alone makes some type of a name for yourself. Like, wow, this dude was the second opponent. Wilder couldn't get out of there. Survival mode like how Hopkins did.
Survival mode gives bad publicity. Survival mode gives you bad publicity. Matt can't go in survival mode.
Hell no, Matt started fucking trying to play the ropes against MD being the crusher. It's gonna be booed. I mean, I'm narrating the whole fight.
The crusher has to pop his jab.
I'm narrating the whole fight. I'm like, MD put his head down. Oh, he's swinging wild bobos.
Matt catches him
with an uppercut.
While y'all jacking my call, let me make my picks.
His leg is wobbly.
Man, if Broner is not on his A game, Granados could throw 100 punches around and wear Broner out. Because I didn't even know till today that Broner was in making weight. When I watched the press conference and they said it was at 147, I was like, why is this at 147? Granados is a 140 pounder, you know?
Donald, you know what, Donald? Since we asked you all those Gerald Washington questions, we kind of stole some of your time. We're going to give you a little bit. I'm sorry, brother. I'm sorry.
Okay. All right, so, and, you know, if Broner ain't on his A game, he could lose because Granados is going to bring it to him. Then Brown and Williams, I say that, I mean, if Williams catch Brown flush on the chin, he could get him out of there. But also, Brownie, he's real slick. If Brownie go in there and be slick for the whole 12 rounds and get some punches off, Williams might not be able to land him flush on the chin. And Averson, he ain't fought nobody. Averson thinks he's somebody just because he beat Shane Mosley by decision. I mean, if he was really anybody, he should have been able to knock a 45-year-old Shane out. But he went the distance with Shane. And Peterson better stop Averson. He better get him out of there and stop him, you know, because for real, he's not really nobody. I don't see nobody on his resume.
And I think Peterson needs to stop him. Peterson's got the experience. He knows how to move. And I think he can make it a real tough fight for him. But, you know, that's all I got on the picks. And hopefully I'll probably see y'all at one of these fights coming up.
Well, hey, so I'll be at Alabama. I know you'll be at Alabama.
Hold on, brother. You didn't make it clear. Who were you picking, Granados or Broner?
You know what? I'm gonna go with Broner. But if Broner loses, I won't be surprised, because him not making weight, that really shocked me. Like I said, when I watched the press conference today and they said the fight was at 147, I was like, what? Why is this at 147? Granados is a 140 pounder. And I figured, well, it had to be at 147 because Broner can't make 140. And he's giving all these stories about how he's making weight. But you're not making weight. You can't even make 140. You're fighting a 140 pounder at 147. Now I can't believe anything Broner is saying, outside of the fact that at the press conference, he didn't talk a bunch of shit and crack a bunch of jokes. I mean, but outside of him being in shape and stuff, I can't believe it, because you're fighting at 147 and not 140. What a 140-pound opponent, you know?
Well, all right, Donald, thanks for calling in. We're going to Mr. Yes, Sir.
Hello?
Yes, sir.
90 seconds.
Right on, right on. California, because me, same shit.
Mr. Granados, yes, sir. Hang up and call back. You only got 90 seconds. You got a bad connection. It's the same thing was happening to Info Joe. Best thing you could do is hang up and call back. You got 90 seconds. Hurry up. Kazbaz, talk to us.
Hey, what's going on?
Kazbaz?
He was there. He sounded so clear, and then just gone. Hold on.
Ladies and gentlemen, I'd like to introduce to you a young fella, and he comes from the Magnolia.
Ooh, nope, that's not him either. Yo, and no, maybe the system. Check the system, producers. Let's get to Muhammad from West Africa.
Yo, what up, what up? Man, Broner not making weight is not a good look, honestly, because he's just showing that he's not dedicated. The agreed weight was 142, I believe. And now they're changing it to 147. But that's not too bad for Broner, because Granados might not have his power at 147. But either way, Broner is at a crossroad. If he loses his fight, his career is going to go down. His payday is going to go down. So I'm inclined to believe that he will do what's necessary to at least be serious when it comes to the fight. I think he's more skilled than Granados, and if he's concentrated, I think he can pull it off. That's my pick as far as that. And what's up, Matt? I got your back, you know?
Oh, thank you, Muhammad. I can't wait to meet you in New York, man. I cannot wait to have a drink with you and just party it up, brother. You know, you're going to have no wife, so we're gonna have a good time. We're going to, Muhammad. It's going to be good.
No problem. I'm going to introduce you to some French hip-hop.
All right. I have no idea what that is, but okay.
French hip-hop, French brother.
Hip-hop.
Oh, French hip-hop. Oh, okay. Hip-hop. I'm down.
You got some French hip-hop lyrics? Just give him a quote real quick so he can understand.
I don't know if he's gonna understand. Okay, let's do this. Ils ont tous voulu ma peau, crapaud devenu prince, cheval cabré sur le capot.
Ooh, spitting that Jean Pascal fire right there.
I took French for 6 years, and I don't know any of that.
You don't know Jean Tempo.
French is like my second language. I speak it fluently.
Killed it.
I can teach you some phrases so you can hook up with the girls. You know, girls in the States, they be liking French, you know?
Sounds good, Mohammed.
Bonjour, je m'appelle Matt.
Good
morning.
Yeah, I know the simple stuff because I did take French from high school.
Bam bam and all that good stuff, aka Method Man quote, baby. Boom.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Hey, Mess, you're messing up my workout, man. I just came from the gym, and since you put pressure on me, I couldn't do 15 pull-ups. I did only 12.
Oh, man, that's not good. We might have to bring a pull-up bar to the appreciation night. See what the heavyweight champ of the world got. He don't do no running. He might can't do no pull-ups either.
No, I think he can.
He got a bar. He got a bar in his gym. He definitely could do pull-ups.
Definitely, definitely. So I think that's about it. Shout out to Steve, MD, and of course my boy Enrique. ¿Qué pasa, Enrique?
Man, this guy knows all languages.
Claro, hombre, yo hablo español también. And I speak Arabic.
Tú hablas español bien claro, hombre. ¿Qué sopa?
Claro, hablo español. ¿Qué pasa? Tú tienes mi ticket, ¿no?
Claro que sí. El hombre Nestor lo tiene, man.
Oye, Mohamed, lo único que él no tiene es una mujer para ti. Tú vas a tener que encontrar tu propia mujer. Oh, no, actually, you married. You married. That don't even count.
Hombre, ya la tengo, ya la tengo.
La está dejando, la está dejando.
Habla mucho idioma, mano.
Oh, man. Listen, Mohamed, thanks for calling in. Blog Talk is down. We could stick around and try to bring it back, or we could just cut up out of here. I mean, look, we're going to cut up out of here. We're going to the quicker we end the show, the faster Monday comes and we start to get that good old 24/7 all access footage of MD versus Matt. You get the build up. You know, you get the meetup. We're gonna have the official weigh-in at Tijuana Flats because we're gonna try, instead of have Matt make weight, we're gonna try to have him gain weight. So we'll give him some food so that the betting line is a little more even. Yeah, we're gonna have a great one, man.
And we wait a little while so he could digest and get ready for this fight. And Muhammad, don't worry, your ticket is safe. It was one of the first purchase tickets. Immediately after the press conference of Keith Thurman versus Danny Garcia. You can follow me at TBV_casualfan. You are now tuned into the Boxing Voice, and that beat means we are out. I'm also on Instagram at Fight Talk. Remember, March 3rd is TBV Appreciation Night. Effing Vodka, Everlast, War Tape, Deontay Wilder the Champ, Peter Quillen, Nestor Gibbs, the Casual Fan, Matt, the producer, Steven Calderon on the West Coast will remain there, I think. And
Gully coming through. Info coming through. Marcus from DC. I mean,
Muhammad, as you heard.
Stainless from Nashville. Muhammad from West Africa.
Mm-hmm. 6,000 miles away, that is.
Hey, Steve Willis is going too. Don't forget. We got talent being there.
Roberto is coming all the way from the UK.
Not Roberto Duran.
Just Roberto from the UK. We also got Jose from Canada coming. T from Toronto. Finally, yo. You know the years. Yo, it's going to be crazy, man.
I hope Andrew Garcia didn't mess up Chinese fans for TBV.
How so?
I don't know. Matt, you know, Matt protesting.
Chinese boxing. I have heard that Chinese boxing lacks any real power.
Where's that from? Where did you find that soundbite?
No, you know that's like from one of those old school karate flicks, bro. Come on.
That's pretty awesome. That's pretty cool.
Come on.
Let those strong hands go, dog. Let those gifted hands go.
Joe Steven, what's the count of the interruptions?
Oh, yes.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
Let's break the beat.
I won.
Hold up.
Okay, so MD, he got third place with 8 interruptions.
Damn, third? Oh, shit. Did I make it to first and second?
Yeah, actually, you definitely made first. You blew everyone out of the water, actually.
No way.
Well, some of his were interactions, so it was kind of hard to, like, differentiate what was him interacting with a caller or just in an interruption. Like, sometimes he would ask questions after the fact. So if you take out the questions, like, in the interview kind of things to kind of pass the time, then it's a lot less. But I'm counting that just because I counted you guys just about every time you guys interrupted. So
what did Ness have?
Oh, Ness had like 20.
How many did I have?
I stopped counting after like 19. I was like, that's stupid. Matt, you actually had 13. You almost doubled. You almost doubled MD. No, you did double his.
How is that not bad? If I had like 20, you had 13, buddy. What the fuck?
No, Ness, I stopped counting.
I have more than you, Ness.
You're on my heels, buddy.
Casual, you had six. The
thing is, but wait, you got to factor in that five of his interruptions were the term cat piss.
Yes.
Yeah.
That's a made up number. Come on. Like you
have to factor in that I drive, right? So it's like sometimes I got to cut in to be like, yo, Matt, you're cutting off stainless. You know what I mean? So I don't know. We don't know what Steven was counting as a cutoff, to be honest. Yeah, he's biased.
Kind of like Trump, you know, pushing the count.
Oh yeah, we'll refine the criteria later.
They were illegal voting.
For all we know, Steven is being biased because he's from California, like Matt. We just never know.
That is funny. I didn't know I was.
We don't know.
Yeah, because you did have six.
I didn't know I was getting counted, man.
Yo, me and Casual are like the most considerate.
I know. I was quiet.
That's some bullshit. We need to start doing that for every show now.
Matt, I don't know.
MD cuts off people more than me.
I don't know if you listen back to the shows, but you might listen back. You might cringe upon what you say.
No, I don't. Well, I do listen back, but I'm not going to cringe at what I said because I've said this before on numerous platforms. So.
Ignorance is bliss, right? Is that what they say?
No, it's called knowledge, motherfucker. But anyways, you can find me at Mixed Combat News on Twitter and my MMA podcast, Mixed Combat Radios, on Patreon, SoundCloud, iTunes, YouTube, etc. Peace out. Enjoy.
And if he wins, you can find MD knocked out on YouTube. If he loses, you can find him on Patreon only because we don't want to, you know, Matt, to be like embarrassed after MD crushes him like Gennady did.
Why would I be embarrassed?
Hey, what's the current betting line? Did it just move like MD the show? Did it move throughout the show?
Move around these parts, man. We really do, bro. We really love you around these parts. You know what I mean? So why would we want to see you? You know.
Ness, did the betting line move since from the beginning to the end of the show?
Did Steven just mute himself on accident? I think
yo,
he did.
Listen to this. This is amazing, bro. I mean, we have the best fans in the world. I just received, I didn't hear anything you said, Steven, but we'll come back to it because this is super duper important and awesome. Like, I mean, I would say sweet, but then I'd sound a little tender. But this came in and it's from Christian and he said, this is $10 a week to get you guys to the UK. If 37 follow suit, that'll be 5,000 barometer to keep my donation. So keep my donation regardless. So he's basically saying if 37 other people pay, I don't know, we got to do that math. Who's the whiz on here? But could 37 other people pay $10 a week by here to May and we make the 5,000 we need to take the team to the UK? Well, the math that I was actually going to tell people is $20 times 250 gets us there. So like if 250 listeners donate $20, no fees. You got to factor in those fees. I'm telling you, they start to add up. So $20 clean, net. Then times 250, we could get to the UK easily. So, you know, and obviously it doesn't have to be 250 people because, you know, some could donate more than others. But if this math works, $10 a week, I mean, anybody doing the math or am I the only one talking?
What did he say? He said $10 a week for 35 people.
37 people.
So so you have to do 37.
$70 a week.
You have to do 30, and it's like, what, 3 months?
Yeah, something like
that. So it's 37 times 30.
So that's $370 times 30.
No, 37 times 30.
37 times 30, but that's 300.
Just use their iPhone calculator. Everybody's
too right now. I'm too lazy right now to get it. 37
you guys are trying
times
to be
30.
Geniuses.
All right, here it goes. Ready? 1, 2, 3. 37 times 30 is 9,000. Ooh, that's a big one. That gives us
Padilla. You sure? 37 times 30? It's 1,110.
No, it's 1,110.
Yeah. That's how much it is. So that his math was wrong. We need math.
He's saying $37 a week, or is he saying?
Well, I mean, it's from the UK, so I don't know.
He's saying $10 a week until May, right?
37 people.
Yes, 37 people.
So that's $370.
Oh, yeah, you're right.
And then times how many weeks are in May till May?
5 weeks in May. There's 30
no, until
days. 3 months.
So that's 90 days. So that's 4, 8, 12.
Times. Oh, he said per week. Wait, he said per week, not per month.
That's 4,000.
Look, it says $10 a week.
You multiply that by 4 and you have 5,000. The math's right.
It's definitely in 10 weeks.
I thought he said by month. So his math is on point.
It's definitely right, in 10 weeks.
So in 10 weeks, is 10 weeks, Steven? So 5 weeks puts us exactly where? What day and month would it put us? Because we need to buy the flights. We can't wait for the whole money to come in because we'll never get the flights cheap.
5 weeks is March 23rd.
March 23rd. So by March 23rd, we should have 2,500. If everyone listening to this show, 37 of you, give $10 a week, TBV goes to see Anthony Joshua. I jump off the Eiffel Tower and hit him in the head with an elbow. Or the Leaning Tower Pizza. Is that all the same place? You know, I don't know anything about that stuff.
No, it's not. Not even close at all.
Leaning Tower Pizza is in Italy, right? Italy.
No, pizza, not pizza.
No, it's definitely in Italy. It's definitely in Italy.
Yo, but $10?
That's what country does Gennady Golovkin hail from?
They say Kazakhstan, right?
They say Kazakhstan.
Kazakhstan.
It's not Kazakhstan. I mean, that's what, what Jim Lampley says. The Kazakhstan warrior. Jim Lampley says it like that.
Kazakh Thunder.
Yeah, Kazakh Thunder. All right. So listen, actually, the best thing to do, right, is because everyone is going to want us to get us to pay to the UK and all that stuff. I still say do it through Patreon so that you get a reward. We still want to, you know, obviously show our appreciation. Could you imagine these beautiful men here, these guys all in the UK and shit, and half of those guys hitting them with cans? You know, they hate us over there anyway. They're gonna be looking for MD in that title. Like, who's the ducker now, MD?
Oh, they made that. There's only one MD.
No, they might be like, there's only one TBV, right? You never know.
Oh, they may be like, Blue Moon. They saw me standing alone.
Yeah, that's over my head. Someone help me, please.
No idea.
They got the rock version of that. It starts off like the Blue Moon. And then they all got hyped up and they start trap music jumping. Nah,
it's still way over my head.
I know. I'll get the clip. I'll show you. And then, oh yeah.
Yo, okay, guys. So we might have moved on, but I rechecked the math. It's actually exactly 12 weeks. So if 12 weeks, $380 every week, that's $4,560.
Oh no, it's gonna take $5,000. It's gonna take minimum $1,000 per host, $500 on the flight if we can lock it in now, because that flight might go up. And we're just assuming that $500 each host for hotel per night is good. Not per night, but excuse me, $500, you know. So like obviously the five of us would either, you know, split into two different rooms, whatever is more convenient, and then, you know, it's like $200 a night in hotel, I'm assuming, maybe $250. I've never even searched over there. You got to leave those things for MD and Matt.
What about our per diem?
Oh, Enrique always wants a per diem. Yo, he's like, yo, buy my ticket to Florida, and I need a $200 a day stipend to eat. I'm like, what the fuck? I'm like, yo, Enrique, you should be giving me something to eat. I'm actually going down there. After paying your flight, I got no money to eat, so I'm going to be eating everything you got.
Yo, are we going to Burn Steakhouse?
I mean, on Enrique.
Try to ride Enrique?
Not on me. On the Boxing Voice. got the Boxing Voice Platinum card over there. It also says.
On MD, we can do a loser pays.
Ooh, look at the confidence in Matthew.
I don't.
He doesn't like that.
Considering you have to ask people money to fly out there, I don't want to have to make you pay for my.
Ooh! Damn. Shot, shot, shot,
low,
shot,
low.
Shot, shot, shot.
So that's a no, MD? So,
I would feel bad. I would feel bad. I really would.
Yo, that's that 50 Cent laugh, guys. Bro, I love it. Yo, so you're ducking another bet, MD, because the man said put the dinner on it. Yo, if you're gonna beat him, take his money and his give him an ass whooping.
But he's not that confident, apparently, I guess.
If you're really gonna like be this immature about it, I will take that bet.
How is it immature to put a bet?
Because this
I don't get why you have to paint me as like this kid that's immature, MD. Like you're 2 years or 3 years older than me. Like
it doesn't make sense. No,
Matt, you're gonna have to earn your respect, bro. This kid doesn't respect.
I know.
There's
sipping whiskey. I'm gonna go beat his ass.
There's called biological maturity, and there's called emotional maturity. And what I'm saying is, you might be 2 or 3 years, whatever, younger than me. The other one is up for interpretation.
Yo, you know who else calls? Hey, Matt, you know who else calls people kids? Keith Thurman. He calls fucking Earl Spencer kid, and there's 28.
Let me beat your ass, MD, just for that comment, because that's messed up. That is.
Why are you like? But like, that's the thing. It's like you talk about safe spaces and all.
You
this,
don't know
like,
me, man.
I don't get him. I don't get.
I got 2.5-year-old kid. You don't know shit about me and my personal life.
Ooh, you gotta.
Maybe I'm a little political. Yeah, I'm living with you with political shit. But you don't know me. You don't know me, son.
He went Angel Garcia. You wanted excitement. You wanted a fucking promotion. Here you go.
Bulletproof when Chinese everywhere.
I'm sorry. Wait. I'm sorry, but
birthing
a child.
I don't want to hear it.
Equate to emotional.
I don't want to hear it, motherfucker. I don't want to hear
That's it. That's the truth as well.
You're disrespectful.
Hard truth.
I'm gonna beat your ass because you're disrespectful.
It's only on Patreon.
Who am I disrespecting? I just want to ask.
You're gonna live stream it.
Who am I disrespecting?
You're disrespecting me. I'm going to beat you on February 21st.
Are you going to let me speak, or is this going to be like, all right, you're disrespecting me when you're the one who is obsessed with me and you're flying across the country to fight me? This is all on you.
It was fun to me in the beginning, but then you started disrespecting me. I was making fun. I was hyping up just for the callers. But no, you started really disrespecting
me. Well, where I'm from is when you say I'm going to beat your ass is that you took it seriously. So the second you said that, this is not like fun and games. Like I'm –
No, it's not funny games right now.
Okay. At least you know it. You need
more people. Yes. Yeah, you can laugh, but you know, you're not gonna be laughing after I beat your ass, because you know why? Because you don't say stuff like that to people. You don't say like, oh, you're emotionally immature when shit like that. When you don't know me, you don't.
How is that
that
offensive? Say that
you're immature. I've never called you immature. I've never said you're intellectually wrong all the time.
Out of the things that people say, that offended you? Out of Ness calling me a fucking idiot all the time and me calling Ness a moron and a fucking idiot, that offended you?
Nigga, the gloves is all. The love
you
is
don't done. Know me. I mean, make sure you know me after February 21st.
It's no love anymore. You guys wanted a fight? You got a fight? You pissed off the hipster, baby.
Yo, you guys don't hear this right here?
Mama's gonna knock you out. Matt's gonna knock you out. Okay, Matt, you got
really
me
resonating.
He got me hype. I swear it's going down. I'm so happy I'm gonna be there.
Me too.
It's gonna be crazy. Yo, what's gonna happen if Keith Thurman is like, yo, man, nah, man, yo, we can't cover this. You know, one of these guys get hurt. There's no insurance for that shit.
No, that's what I'm saying. Just sign like a waiver. Every gym has a waiver. It's like, oh, you're gonna work out here. You can't if you get hurt. It's crazy, bro. That's the contract.
Let me tell you something. I am Make a Wish Foundation. If Keith Thurman says no, we're going to fucking Erickson Lubin's gym. It's just that simple. You know what I mean? The Lube Master, the Hammer will definitely let MD drop the hammer on fucking Matt for sure. You wanted to see blood? Are you not entertained? No, let me stop. Not at the mercy.
Look at this. Look at
Ness, you're like getting so power hungry, dude.
Look at Ness, the instigator, getting people hurt for his own entertainment.
No, I would
even be promotion. I would do you next year.
Listen, I wouldn't do it. You seen when I got in there with Thurman and with Porter, you know, he gave me one shot, went down. I'm like, look, you're the man. I'm not gonna get in there and try to be tough. This is his job. You guys want to act like fighters? Go ahead. I'll record.
Nah, you're trying to promote. You're the promoter.
Yo, with that being said, I am out. Shout out to the Boxing Voice, TBV underscore.
Yo, speaking of out, Enrique, guess who just checked in? TJ's dad, Tom Velasquez, who's also going to be at the TBV Appreciation Night. Yo, and it's actually super duper special because that is the night of his son's, you know, fight. He's actually fighting on the March 4th card, and they're still going to come through and show some love. He's actually listening live saying we're going crazy over there. He wants to see that sparring. MD, they're watching. This is the DSG gym. You never know. You might get a shot. Next thing you know, you don't even have to be a doctor. Fuck it. You're like the next Danny Garcia.
Mm-hmm. Or, you know, what's his name? Barrera. No, who fought Manny Pacquiao 5 times? Knocked Manny out once?
Oh, Marquez.
Marquez. Yes, you can be the Marquez. Marquez, you know, on the road to being an accountant, became the world champion.
Oh, Matt, you don't have like any Mexican, right? You're not like undercover Mexican or something down from over there. How are we building this? So who is it? I mean, we got the Jewish doctor. He's the new rabbi and shit.
Oh, that's
bringing awesome. It to Florida. Ever since Yuri Foreman had to fight, in Florida, we got a lot of fucking Jews fighting over there. So, I mean, what's going on? What are you? I mean,
I'm Portuguese.
Oh, so it's like okay.
He's also offended by the Jew statements.
Yeah.
Well, I mean, this is what MD says. He says that all day about the rabbi. This is what he does. I didn't say that. He opened the door.
What, about Yuri Foreman?
Yeah.
Yeah.
If he could call Yuri Foreman a Jew rabbi, I mean,
he's a rabbi. Yeah. I mean, whatever.
Technically, MD is a Jew, and, you know, fuck.
I think that MD versus Matt is going to come down to, I think whoever talks the best crap in the ring, because I think they're both going to be crap talkers when they're in the clinches, and you know when they're digging at the body, they're going to be talking shit like, oh, I knew you were going to do that. Oh yeah, well I thought you were going to do this.
No,
that's what they're going
to
do.
Our experience? Do you think they're going to be able to punch and talk?
Oh yeah, I see it. Definitely. You think that they're going to like leave it all? No, nah, come on, no.
Oh man, you're pumping this one up big time, man.
They're going to be trash talking in the ring. I'm excited.
Hey, yo, you think highly of both of them. I didn't think MD had it in him to throw punches and talk. MD, could you shit talk and knock this kid out?
I mean, my focus is to win.
The double.
What?
All right. Yo, we've been here forever, man.
And that's it.
Their outros, and we're out of here, man. Casual, you're ready. You're sleeping over there. Go ahead first before you knock out. Where's this pillow?
Yo, Everlast Pillows, TBV _ casual fan. That is my my Twitter, and my Instagram is at Fight Talk. Yes, that's me.
I bet you sleep with the nightlight.
Mm-hmm.
Matthew?
Yep. I already did my outro, but obviously you can follow me at Mixed Combat News on Twitter, and Mixed Combat Radio is my MMA podcast. You can find that on all platforms.
And the good doctor, a.k.a. the surgeon.
You could follow me at BoxingMD1 on Twitter.
Mr. Producer.
You can find me at Calderon92 on Twitter.
Muhammad.
Unless you wear.
He fell asleep. He always falling asleep on Skype. We got to love him. We're going to give him the Fall Asleep on Skype Award, this guy.
It's like 525 over there.
Hey, still fell asleep on Skype. I am your host, Nestor Gibbs. Find me on Instagram and Twitter at Nestor. No, at NestGTO. But you could only find this exclusive on Patreon later.